those ear goggles, bitches. It's time for some pop goulash. My name is Ruben, and I'm glad to have you all listening and talking into your ear holes tonight. Got a special guest in the studio down in the Hood Cave tonight, a dude that I've known for the better part of 23, 24 years, I would say, all the way back to high school.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah, and I'm glad to have him glad to have him on the show tonight, because it's been a long, long time since we hung out, and I'm sure we'll get into that story.
Yeah, it's been about 8 years.
Yeah, stories need to be told. So
yes, they do.
But sitting across the table from me, we have Christos Georgakopoulos, also known as in our small circles as Chips.
Hey now.
But I don't think he goes by that anymore.
No, it's been a while.
Yeah, very long time.
It's been a while, probably. So. Since 1997.
Yeah, dude. So yeah, how you been, man? It's been a while.
It's been a while. Yeah, good. You know, just as you know, getting older and more responsible, dude. And more gray hair. And
yeah, dude, I was noticing that. Yeah. I was like, holy shit, dude.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, it's really fucking nice,
dude. It's not a bad thing, dude. Like,
it's good to see you, by the way.
I actually have gray hair envy. Like, with,
oh yeah,
yeah, absolutely. Like. Yeah. I'm glad that I'm not going bald.
Yeah.
So I've got that going for me. Yes. But like you and Eli is going gray.
Uh-huh.
And I got a couple of other friends of mine that are gray already. And I'm like, dude, I'm 40 for Christ's sake. Can I get like more jealous than just like one stupid gray hair that, like every day?
Yeah. So. I'm glad I'm not losing it. It's depressing though. Not depressing. It's always surprising whenever I go get my hair cut. And they put, like, the black cape, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And
you're like, why'd you pepper my...
Yeah, exactly. And you look down, and you're like, holy shit, that's a lot of... You know, when you see it in the mirror, you can't tell as much.
Yeah. But... Well, I'm sure it was a gradual thing, too, though. Yeah?
Sure.
You're like, I don't know. It just woke up one morning.
Yeah, that's kind of how I feel.
Yeah.
It's like an oh shit.
Right?
Yeah.
That's hilarious.
That's how it goes.
Yeah. So, let's see here. God, what have you been doing for the last 20 years? I know you're working in the medical field, or at least
I still do. I still do. Yep, still been at the same place for 11 years now.
Damn.
Almost 12. Before that, I once I left college down at U of I, I went to upstate New York, and I taught at Cornell.
Did you really?
Yeah, I taught at Cornell University for about 3 years-ish, a little over 3 years.
Really?
Yep. At their School of Hospitality Management.
Okay.
So it was like still being like in college, you know. Mm-hmm. So it was like a real job, but you're on a college campus. So definitely saw tons of live music, tons of bands, hung out at the, you know, where all the bars where the bands were playing and stuff. And it just got to a point where I was like, all right, I need to grow up, man. Like,
tons of mo shows.
Well, yeah, it was just like being in college still. Just
really?
I said I didn't go to school for a class. I had a job, and so
right,
you know,
right,
which was fun. But yeah, it was time to get out of that atmosphere.
Yeah, I can see that for sure. I mean, I guess like because I moved back because I got, you know, I went to NIU, and then like years later I returned back. I bought a house, but
yeah.
You know, I wasn't teaching at the school or anything. I was just living there, and I was in the townie section, so I never went anywhere, like, close to campus. I'm like, nope.
Yeah.
Nope.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, so you, I think the last time I actually saw you, I bought fish tickets from you.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah, and that was, God, that had to been...
I'm trying to think of when that was. I was on the way up here tonight. I was trying to remember when that was. And I'm like, I could have sworn I hooked Ruben up with tickets at some point, but I didn't remember.
I think that was about seven years ago.
Maybe.
No. It was longer than that because I hadn't met my wife yet.
Okay.
So that was maybe 08, 09.
I'm trying to think of what show that was.
It was for...
was it up at Alpine?
Alpine. I think it was one of the last times they played Alpine.
That was June of 2009.
Yeah.
Yep.
That sounds about right.
Because I got tickets for both nights, and I didn't want both nights, so I hooked you up with one of the nights, and Abby and I went to the other show.
Right, and I traded some
tapers
that you knew, and I actually got into the pavilion that night, which was pretty sweet.
Yep.
And then I'm like, dude, how do I get a copy of this? They're like, oh, you know, just go on BitTorrent. And I'm like,
what the fuck is that?
Is a BitTorrent? I felt like Jay on... In Jane Silent Bob Strike mm-hmm. Back, where he's like, what the fuck is the internet?
Yeah.
Like, I'm like, I have no idea. And then I go on to BitTorrent, and they're like, your computer has now been compromised. I'm like, son of a bitch.
Yeah. Yeah.
I had no idea what I was doing.
Yeah.
I still don't have a copy of that show.
Yeah, well.
Yeah.
It's so, out there somewhere.
Right. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. It's just a matter of hunting it down if I really wanted it.
Exactly.
So you actually tape shows.
I do.
How did you get into that?
Part of it was, you know, I've always gone to see live music, mm-hmm. right? And that's something I've always done since high school, you know? And part of it was going, I mean, I always went to the shows. Really what made me interested in it was I just love playing with electronic stuff, mm-hmm. gadgets and whatever. So it was, I started reading about it and started, you know, getting a little bit more interested in it. And again, it was kind of an excuse to go to a show and actually get to play with some cool microphones and wires and cables and, mm-hmm. and do that, all that kind of shit. And then actually have a copy of it to take home at the end of the day. And you can go back and listen to it and have it for your own, you know, and then share it with people as well.
For sure.
I started taping when I was living in New York. So I think the first show I taped was back in 2005.
Okay.
I was Gathering the Vibes Music Festival in upstate New York. We were there for 3 days mm-hmm. and just went through tons of batteries
of course.
To keep the recorder going all weekend long. But yeah, that's really, and yeah, that's really it. You know, it was more so for myself.
Mm-hmm.
After I got the hang of recording, then I started learning about how you cut them up, process them, put them online.
Sure.
I've posted a ton of stuff on Archive.
Mm-hmm.
And also done the BitTorrent stuff as well. So I learned that and learned how to not compromise your computer with crazy viruses from Russia and China in the process. But yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Is there a show that you can pinpoint that you're like, that was the best show I've ever recorded?
That's interesting. There's, you know, I don't know if I have the best. Over the years, your as tapers call it, your rig, right? All the various equipment you use. So it's a combination of, you know, microphones you use, if you're using a preamp for it, what type of recorder you're using, it all creates a different sound. So mm-hmm. you can listen to 5 different recordings of the exact same concert and they all sound very, very different just based on the equipment you use. So,
right. I'm guessing probably location in the room that you are
all of
that as well.
Room. Yeah, I mean there's been times where I've recorded in the same room with different setup and you can definitely tell mm-hmm. the difference. You know, recorded the same band in the same room
right.
over a period of a few years and it sounds different. So, a recording that I really, really enjoy that just sounds awesome to me was I actually taped Mr. Blotto at the Kinetic Playground in Chicago.
Oh, really?
Gosh, it must have been 2007, 2008. I don't know. Abby and I were together at that point, so the late 2000s.
Mm-hmm.
And just the location of the room, the sound system in that place was awesome. And the setup I had at that time in my mind was like the best setup that I had. You know, I had a piece of equipment that I have sold since then and I regret selling it. And
really?
They don't make it anymore. Ugh. It's hard to find. So one of those things. But that's one that sticks out in my head quite a bit.
So now the Kinetic, is that the original? I know that there was a Kinetic Playground back in the 60s. Is it the same building, or did they just take the name?
I have no idea. Okay. Yeah, I mean, it's essentially kind of across the street, down the street from the Aragon Ballroom.
Right.
Yeah, that place. So I don't know if that's the same one. I know you're saying there mm-hmm. there was.
Yeah, because I remember working at Kiss the Sky. Steve would constantly talk about going to see The Who and mm-hmm. Zeppelin and all these bands that are like the shit, you know. But when they were just regular touring bands,
yeah,
back in the 60s.
I wonder, because that's, at least as it exists today, it's not a big place.
No, it is, yeah.
You know? So, God, if you saw The Who there, that'd be fucking amazing.
Yeah, right. But yeah, he would talk about going to see the Who and Led Zeppelin on mm-hmm. a double bill.
Yeah.
And then going back, like, in, like, the middle of the set break or whatever between the two bands to go buy, like, the Kinks and, like, you know, Herman's Hermits or something like that for, like, the following week.
That's cool.
Yeah. Yeah, it's pretty rad. So, but yeah, fucking live music is incredible, dude. I don't get to go as much as I'd like to anymore.
Me neither.
Like, and as far as Blotto, dude, I used to see Blotto all the fucking time, mm-hmm. dude. Like, especially living out in DeKalb.
Out in Autos.
Oh my God, I miss that venue much, dude.
Is that still around or no?
No, they leveled it.
No shit.
Yeah, and then like apparently they just condemned Lord Stanley's Annex and Lord Stanley's, the bar that was right next door to it. But for Otto's, apparently there was a lot of like structural damage. They just never took care of that place. And like even after the guy who was the booking agent for the House of Blues took over. And he was the guy that was getting George Clinton to come through. He got you know, Snoop Dogg came through, Soul Asylum, all of these like, you know, mid-range acts at that point. Like you know, they were big freaking bands, but like, you know, they just weren't in their prime anymore. But even then, like, you could, like, see holes into the basement from, like, the third floor.
That place is a dump.
It was a dump, but I loved it so much, man. But, yeah, and then apparently just the end of last fall, or the end of last summer, they tore it down. They tore that whole corner of the block down.
Yeah, I taped Blotto there 5-6 times over the years.
Yeah, I used to go there all the time in college to see them. Like, it was a blast. They were so good live, and I haven't seen them since. Well, I take that back. I saw them once, and they had a new keyboard player. Because the last time I saw them, they had the big dude.
Dave, yeah.
And then they had a different drummer. And, Dave, I guess, I don't know, it's speculation from what I've heard, but I heard he just turned into a big mess.
He got sick. He had a brain tumor and had a pretty serious surgery. Yeah.
Really?
Yep, yep. Oh, so
he was fucking amazing.
Yeah, they had done a couple of shows a few years ago, just kind of raising money to help with medical bills and shit. But they every once in a while, probably about, I'm going to say maybe 2-3 times a year, they'll do a special show where they'll have him come back.
Very cool.
And play. Obviously, is, you know, having a brain surgery kind of fucks you up, you know, but yeah, so he's, you know, he's around still, but don't know what prompted the issue, but
The last time I saw him, he played so hard that like at set break, he got up and passed the fuck out.
I believe it. Like, yeah, he's amazing.
Bam.
Yeah.
Like, and he was a big dude. Yeah, like, you heard him fall.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. They were excellent. And gosh, man, like, I remember they used to do like Stash by Fish, and like the lead singer dude used to paint a picture during it, and like that would be like their set break song, and he'd hand it out to somebody in the audience and whatnot. But like, dude, I used to love going to see those guys.
We still catch them every once in a while. Yeah, so go. I'll make, you know, in before kids, we would see them all the time.
Well, it seems like, because even if you go on their website, it seems like they don't really play out much anymore either.
They play out several times a week.
Do they really?
Yeah, they do. They just haven't changed their website in a long time.
Well, that would probably explain it, because I'm like, damn, these guys were good.
They still play a couple times a week. They always set up like a residency somewhere. So they call it a Tipsy Tuesdays. So they'll pick a bar somewhere in Chicago, and every Tuesday night they'll play there.
Oh, really?
And then they always do like a Friday night, Saturday night. Last night they played at Pheasant Run.
Did they really?
Down the road, yeah.
Well, shit.
So
where was I last night?
They're around.
I was drinking beer last night.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, well, I'm so out of it, man. I used to be cool.
Yeah.
Or at least I thought I was.
No, you weren't.
No, I wasn't. Yeah, you guys just tolerated me, that's all. But yeah, it was like same thing with Humphreys McGee. Like, I remember seeing those dudes at Otto's for like $5.
Yeah.
Now you can't get a ticket for less than 50 to see them anymore.
Yeah, and I've seen them a couple times, only because I'm not a huge fan. I don't like them. I don't hate them. I'm indifferent.
Not your thing.
They are in that whole jam band scene. So you go to a festival, a lot of times they'll be there. So yeah, I've seen them a couple times.
Yeah, they were good live, man. They had their own thing going for them.
Do you ever go down to summer camp?
That's
their thing, right? Like, is that their, or is that, it's like Moe and Humphreys?
Yeah, it was Moe and Humphreys, I think. No, I've never been, man.
Yeah.
I've never been.
Have you ever done the festival thing at all?
No.
No?
No, because, like, really, by the time, like, I had the money to start doing those kind of things, I had a big boy job and responsibilities. I couldn't really, like, I couldn't really do much for it. So I was like, meh, you know, that, and I had a mortgage. So you can't really do much with a mortgage and a single income in the house, so. But, yeah, it's like, fuck, man. And seriously, dude, that Fish show that you got me tickets for was a great show.
Yeah.
It was a great show. They did a bunch of stuff that I never, because it had been, there had been a bit of a gap from the last time I'd seen them until then.
Yeah.
And, so there was a bunch of new stuff that they did. Like, they were doing stuff off of Joy, I think, at that time. And then, no, it wasn't Joy. It wasn't Joy. Because Joy hadn't come out yet. Can't remember what it was. Maybe Round... It was after Round Room, like way after Round Room.
Yeah.
Because there was quite the gap between Round Room and Joy. But yeah, I haven't seen Fish since.
I haven't either.
No, no, I take that back. Kirsten got me tickets, and I took Kirsten to see... Or I got tickets and took Kirsten to see Fish at Alpine, one of the last times they played up at Alpine. And she was just like, yeah, it's not my scene.
Uh-huh.
Like, not her scene at all.
Yeah.
So, but then again, 90% of the music I listen to is... Not her scene.
Yeah.
So, I, you know, like, we went to Pearl Jam, and she's just like, I'm like, dude.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. I last time I saw Fish was that summer of 2009. Back in the mid, late 90s is when I was heaviest into them.
Yeah.
So, like, 96 through 99. 96, 97, 98, those 3 years, I probably saw a total of 20 shows.
Good God.
So, yeah, and after that, after, like, 99-ish, I always liked them, but I didn't see them nearly as much.
Right.
And since, like, 99, 2000, I've probably maybe seen them 3 times, you know?
And now that I think about it, dude, the very first time I saw Fish... was from tickets that I paid for and bought from you.
It could have been.
Because, yeah.
I was in those summers, like 96, 97, 98, I always did the mail order.
Yeah.
And I always buy a bunch of tickets.
No, this was 2000. This was farmhouse era.
Okay, maybe.
And I got tickets for Deer Creek for the first 2 nights at Deer Creek. All and right. I bought them from you.
Maybe.
Because I wouldn't have gone otherwise.
Yeah.
Because I think you were supposed to go, and I was like, dude, I'll go with you. And then at some point you were like, dude, I can't go.
Yeah.
So then I called Jill. Quincy.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm like, dude, I got these 2 tickets to you know, Fish. Do you want to go? And she's like, I will be there.
Nice.
And we met up there. It was cool. A blast, man.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
there you go.
I don't know. It's crazy.
I'm your ticket man.
Right.
I have no recollection of that, but
really,
it's very possible.
Yeah.
I don't doubt you. It's just
nah.
That was a long time ago.
Very long time ago.
Yeah.
I got this steel trap memory that just houses all this unimportant shit. So. But have you seen any good music lately?
The last real concert that I went to, not like a bar, was Dead and Company at Wrigley Field last summer.
Is it?
Yep.
Right on.
So I still keep up with that. That's...
Keep talking.
Yeah. That's my... That's my scene. You know, for many years, a huge Deadhead.
Yeah.
So I still, when they come through town, I'll see them.
Was John Mayer playing
with
them?
John Mayer, yeah.
Okay.
Makeup, the current formation, which is good. I actually, I was very skeptical.
Mayer's a hell of a guitar player.
Yeah, dude. Well, and I knew that. But you know, of course, even now when I'll go see Dead and Company, I always just laugh. I'm like, I hope they play Your Body's a Wonderland. Yeah. But I was very skeptical because, great guitar player, but. You know,
how does he fit into that
matrix? And I was pleasantly surprised. You know, I mean, you know, there's been a several different lineups of Dead related stuff. There's, you know, there's Dead, there's Further, you know, and they all have kind of their own different group. You know, there was when they did the GD50 shows with Trey, that was awesome. But you know. So I gave it a chance. I'm like, yeah, I'll go check it out. And I was actually, wow, this is pretty fucking good. So I've seen them a few times now.
Nice.
And they're coming around this summer again.
Are they playing Wrigley or?
No, they're playing Alpine Valley.
Are they?
They're doing 2 shows at Alpine. I unfortunately cannot go to those.
Oh, really?
My wife and I are going to try and hit the show down in Cincinnati.
So. Oh, at Riverbend?
I couldn't tell you. Maybe.
Dude, Riverbend is an incredible venue.
Yeah, yeah. It could be.
Yeah,
It's an outdoor place,
yeah, yeah,
right?
Then yeah. It's probably Riverbend.
It's gotta be, yeah.
Because I saw Fish there in 2000, maybe 2001.
Yeah.
And it's crazy because when you walk in to the venue, you come in at the top of the venue, at the lawn, and then you have to walk your way down to the pavilion area.
Like Alpine.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, just like Alpine. Yeah. Well, who knows if people out there have been to Alpine either.
Yeah.
And then... But there's literally a river behind the stage.
Oh, that's cool.
And you can actually see boats like going up and down the river.
So they probably camp out and listen to the music.
Oh, yeah for sure.
That's cool. Nice.
But then again, they're also listening to it from behind the stage where all the music is going the other direction.
Yeah.
But Yeah, it's a cool venue, cool. man. It's yeah, a cool venue.
So we're going to try and hit that up.
If you see a red Chuck Martin, like, or a Chuck Taylor stuck in the mud there, chances are it's mine. There was a massive rainstorm the night that we went to go see Fish there during the first set.
Awesome.
And when you're on two hits of LSD, it just makes for a really weird experience.
That'll do it for you.
Yeah. And then as we were leaving, my foot got suctioned into the mud as we were leaving. So, yeah, I was minus one shoe on the way out.
I had a similar experience seeing Rat Dog up at SPAC upstate New York.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Rained really, really hard.
Yeah,
it was cool. It was right before the show started. It started like bad.
The
sky just opened up and just dumped. And Bob Weir got on stage and said, "All right, guys, I recorded that show." And
did you?
it was pretty interesting because I was out on the lawn recording.
Ooh.
And I knew it was gonna rain, so there's precautions you can take to keep your stuff afloat. So to speak. And that's actually one of my up there favorite recordings, not from a quality perspective, because you totally capture the severity of the storm. Mm-hmm. But then also, like I said, right before the concert started, Bob Weir told everybody on the lawn, say, listen, guys, there's a big storm coming. Everybody be friendly. Everybody out on the lawn, come into the pavilion. If there's any empty seats, fill in the aisles.
Nice.
Just be kind to each other. And just everybody just came in like that was just soaked. And
very cool.
They just rocked it, man. Like nice. Hard. It was awesome.
Yeah. That's very cool, man.
Yeah.
Very cool. Yeah.
So that's the other thing I like about recording stuff like that is mm-hmm.
you get those little nuances that you might miss otherwise. Yeah,
exactly. More so than there's stuff that you'll capture. The actual feeling, the electricity in the crowd
mm-hmm.
that you don't necessarily get from the version they sell you after the show. That's a soundboard.
Oh,
you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
You really get a vibe of what was going on in the crowd.
Yeah,
know?
Absolutely.
Yeah. All the screams, all the cheers, all the, all the
idiots singing off key.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, so.
Yeah. Yeah. Cause you definitely for sure get the, cause I have a bunch of, I got a ton of live recordings mm-hmm. and some that were, officially released. Some are soundboards. Some are, some dude sitting out in the crowd.
Yeah.
we used to have a guy at Kiss the Sky who would come in. We called him CDJ. Never really knew what his real name was, but he always had really great boots.
Yeah.
And he brought them in, and that's how we got our bootleg selection was he would bring them in. And he knew dudes. He was getting them first generation.
Okay.
He's like, I knew this one guy who went into the venue. Because this is like non-taper friendly stuff.
Yeah.
And he's like, he knew somebody who was a doctor, got a double arm body cast, had the microphones stuck into his hands, and recorded that way. Got into like the handicapped accessible seating, like got a great spot, and just recorded that way.
Get out of here.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's funny.
Yeah. It's crazy what the lengths that people would go through to like get a live recording.
Yeah.
From
there's
a
whole, there's a whole, I don't want to call it a scene, but yeah, there's definitely
totally a scene.
A scene of people who go record pretty much strictly bands that don't allow recording.
Yeah.
And so there's websites out there where they'll be like, hey, here's kind of telling you, here's how to do it. Mm-hmm. Here's a great setup. Here's some equipment you can use. They'll use, a lot of times they use like the smaller, like lavalier type microphones
mm-hmm.
and like put them inside a hat or something, like Kangol hats. Like,
oh, really?
If you're ever at a show that doesn't allow recording and somebody's wearing a Kangol hat, there's
a
possibility they could be.
That's hilarious.
Not to bust anybody out, but there's certain types of hats you can wear that don't muffle the sound. And
it's
interesting. Or if you're at a show and everybody's dancing around and there's somebody just standing perfectly still, that dude's probably recording.
That's hilarious. That's hilarious. Yeah, I'm I remember I used to talk to a bunch of kids that would have a bunch of live recordings at the store, and they'd bring them in, and I'm like, oh, dude, like this one kid gave me we were kind of trading back and forth for a while, but I would have been like banned from the community, I guess, because like I would take my recordings and be like, dude, John, this is a great one.
Yeah.
And I would trade it with John. John would record it, turn it around, and sell it to other stores.
Yeah.
Well, it got back to this one kid that it's very possible that some of the recordings he was giving me was getting into the hands of somebody who was selling them.
Yeah.
So he handed me a bunch. Big Cypress. Fish's Big Cypress. And he handed me, 10 discs. He's like, there it is. It's the whole thing. I'm like, sweet, dude. Yeah. Because, I was like, man, I just want the music.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And I went to go play him, and he didn't finalize any of the discs.
So they were worthless.
Yeah. He's like, and I'm like, dude, can you finalize this? He's like, yeah, sure. And he came back and probably gave me the same stack of discs. He's like, fuck you. Yeah. I'm like,
You know, right, hey, fuck me.
Yeah, right. I still got a ton of free music out of it, so
that's cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've really only just recorded bands that allow it and encourage it.
Right.
You know, I never tried to deal with being secretive about it. I've never sold anything. You right. know, that's I don't care.
Yeah. Well, you know, I was unscrupulous in my early 20s. So, but yeah, like because I used to track down tons of Pearl Jam recordings.
Yeah.
I'm a huge
Yeah,
Pearl
they don't
Jam
allow recording, right?
So. No, because they release them all themselves. They just do straight.
It's funny because, and that's what, you know, the Dead and even Fish now, too. I mean, after the show, you stop by the booth and you can get it.
Oh, really?
Yeah. A lot of those bands now, you can buy them
straight from
at the show,
mm-hmm.
or you go like onto their website the next day and you can download it.
Right.
FLAC, MP3, whatever.
Yeah.
Those are pretty high quality recordings.
Yeah,
right?
Just
straight off the board, and they're mixed specifically for resale.
Yeah.
You know? So, but they still allow tapers in the audience.
Yeah.
You know,
mm-hmm.
and it's a different version.
Right. Yeah. Because I remember like the big thing was like I think it was in '97 or '90. It was '98. It was Pearl Jam's 98 tour was the first time they released the entire tour to retail.
Oh, wow.
It was somewhere between 30 and 50 shows
were
released en masse to retailers.
Yeah.
And yeah, they were like, here you go. Here's the entire tour, you know. So
that's cool.
Really just to cut off the bootleggers. Because seriously, I mean, there have been times where I've bought a bootleg CD. Because like I said, I don't know BitTorrent from a fucking Pop-Tart.
Yeah. Sure.
You know, so it's like I wouldn't know where to go to even find some of this stuff. So like, I remember Crow's Nest?
Yeah. Yeah.
Dude, Crow's Nest used to have a bootleg section and they would never let you listen to this shit before you bought it. And I'm thinking I'm buying some like new studio album I'd never heard of, and I'd pick up an album and I'm like,
it's a shit
and they're like, no, we don't take returns. I'm like, motherfucker, what? Are you kidding me?
And it's always expensive as hell too.
Oh dude, they were like $30 easily. I mean, sometimes you got some gems, but a lot of the times it was just like ugh.
Yeah,
you know, somebody had it in their armpit and you know, it was rerun trying to record the Doobie Brothers. So
I always enjoyed reading. There's several different books out there that kind of talk about this stuff. You can find stuff online too, but just reading how people recorded shows in the 70s and the equipment. You know, to me, like I said, it's all like the gadgets, like electronics and just like, so back in the, you know, 70s, people would bring in little mini reel-to-reel recorders.
Yeah, it's crazy,
you know,
right?
Like stuff like that was pretty neat. And so you listen to a show and it cuts off in the middle of a song and then a minute and a half later into the song, it picks up again.
Right, because somebody found their other tape.
Well, they
reloaded
the
tape.
Out, you know, and,
yeah.
Or you'd hear people, you know, there'd be certain venues that the Dead would play at that the venue didn't want people recording. And then so you hear stories about, you know, hippies like coming in with a wheelchair. And like they'll be sitting on top of a huge Nakamichi cassette deck, you know, that takes 10D batteries. And they sit on top of it and put a blanket over their lap and wheel it into the venue and sit in a wheelchair section. And somehow,
I'm a vet, man.
Yeah, exactly.
That's hilarious.
So that kind of stuff is always, for me, it's kind of fun to read and listen to and learn about. And,
for sure.
Yeah.
What kind of equipment do you use?
Right now, I never really got into the really high-end equipment. I mean, there's people that I know that I became friends with over the years who tape, and they have, you know, two microphones. Each of them costs $750.
Wow.
You know, and the recorder they use is like a high-end. They'll use high-end recording gear that they'll use, like, on movie sets and stuff like
really?
That. That's time-coded and everything. Like, really hardcore stuff. That was just a way, you know, people spend $2,000 on a recorder.
Yeah.
I don't. I don't have those resources.
No, absolutely not. So, you've got children.
Right. Well, even before then, I didn't have those resources. Right. And I didn't really care that much. You know, I it was more fun. So right now, I've had the same equipment set up for several years now. I don't use it nearly as much as I used to. But well,
again, you've got children. You've got other priorities.
But it's like, even if I sold it, I wouldn't get that much money for it. So I just keep it. So I got a pair of mics, the Aventone CK1s. They look cool. They sound decent. They're... For two mics, it was like, $250, $300.
Mm-hmm.
And the mics come with three different caps,
capsules.
So you got an omnidirectional cap. You can have a cardioid or hypercardioid. So it's kind of neat. You have the versatility there. And then I have a Fostex FR2LE recorder.
Okay.
Which I sent off to a guy to get modified. Yeah, mm-hmm. He changed some of the preamps and stuff in it to give it a cleaner, crisp sound.
Does it record digital or does it record to...
Yeah, it records to a compact flash card.
Okay.
If they still even make those. But but yeah. Yeah. Okay. So it's, and it's really, you know, it's actually a nice setup. So it's, you know, it's got the XLR. It's kind of like a, you have in front mm-hmm. of you right now.
Yeah.
Phantom power. So it'll power mics for you. And I just use a... it's like a backup battery that they use for laptops.
Sure.
You know? Yeah. It's a 2000 or 20,000 milliamp battery. And
right.
Run that recorder for a week straight.
Really?
Know? So that's all you need as far as power. And that's it. And mm-hmm. then I just bring it home and stick the memory card to my computer and chop it up and do whatever I want to do with it.
Right.
If I get around to posting it somewhere,
mm-hmm.
I'll do that. But more often than not, I just keep it for myself
yeah.
and share it with my wife or whatever. Cause usually she'll be there with me at the show. So
sure. I there was one dude from back at work. I was going to their house to do some stuff, and the guy had, God damn it, Chris. the guy had an entire wall
mm-hmm.
of cassette tapes.
Oh, wow.
Of just different shows That's that had cool. been recorded, yeah. whether I didn't really get deep into whether he had recorded them or, like, who had recorded yeah. these particular things, but, like,
That's cool.
he had an entire, like, wall of just cassette tapes.
Yeah.
I'm like, I don't even know how you're going to play those things That's anymore.
Funny. I've got probably two, like, you know, boxes of, like, reams of paper. Like
yeah, yeah, yeah.
Paper. I got two of those full of cassettes.
Wow.
They're all mostly dead stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But I have so much, like, on my computer.
I'm sure.
I've got probably, I'm gonna guess around 2 terabytes of just, like, live dead shows.
Damn.
Yeah.
Well, is it all lossless or is it all like...
It's all lossless, yeah.
Okay, so they're all bigger
FLAC
files.
They're FLAC, or a lot of them are, like, before FLAC, there was, like, SA shortened mm-hmm. files. And so, yeah, it's all... So I essentially, from a... And I've been wanting to continue to build my collection, but from a Grateful Dead perspective, I have 1966 through 1974, all their recordings. And usually it's multiple versions of each show because... Mm-hmm.
You got five different
dude,
dudes.
Yeah, this dude taped one. There's a soundboard.
Mm-hmm.
I have...
It'd be interesting to see if you could layer all of those recordings on top of one another.
People do that. Yeah,
to get like some weird multi-directional type feel for it.
So a lot of the more famous shows, like the Barton Hall in 1977, Grateful Dead at Cornell, there's people out there who have taken the soundboard because mm-hmm. Back in the day, the Grateful Dead would circulate soundboard recordings. They don't, you know,
they give a
Jerry's
shit.
Kind of philosophy was once I play the notes, they're yours.
Right.
I don't give a shit, you know. Mm-hmm. So there's people who've taken the soundboard and then maybe two other audience recordings.
Sure.
And we'll make a 5.1 kind of surround mix.
Nice.
Which is pretty awesome.
It sounds like it'd be really cool.
So you get
cool.
the clarity of the soundboard, but you also get the feeling of the crowd and the cheering.
Yeah, for
and,
sure.
You know, kind of like in the rear speakers if you played in a surround
sound.
Yeah, so people will do that. Yeah.
That's cool.
It's a thing.
That'd be interesting
to
get your hands on one of those.
Mm-hmm. I have a few of them.
I'm sure.
Yeah. So I got all 70. I got 77 and 78, mm-hmm. all the recordings. And then I've got... chunks of like 87 and 88.
God, that's going to be like thousands of hours worth of.
Oh yeah. Yeah. And there's, you know, and there's people out there who got the entire from 1965 to 1995, you know,
really
like just digitally. So I'm,
wow.
I try to get my hands on when I can,
mm-hmm.
and get some of the stuff. I was pretty active, many years ago on a website, tapersection.com. And, that's where I learned a lot about taping
mm-hmm.
and being part of the taping community and learning just kind of the ins and outs and how to do stuff. And you could buy and sell gear like one person to person on there.
Sure.
But they did it there. You know, there's a group of people for a while who would just kind of set up like a mailing list, not a mailing list, but it's like you'd sign up and that, you know, a hard drive would show up in the mail and you'd
really?
Copy whatever they had on it. And then
crazy.
you'd pay for postage and send it off to the next guy, you know. And so that's just kind of how
it's like a chain letter,
kind
almost.
Of, yeah. But it was they would physically send you a hard drive with like a
wow.
bunch of dead music, bunch of dead shows on it, and you just copy it to your own, and then contribute, load up whatever you
sure.
had that wasn't already on there, and just
mm-hmm.
send it off to the next guy, you know.
Crazy.
So it's kind of neat, yeah.
Very cool,
yeah.
Wow, so I didn't know it like went that deep, man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, it used to be tapes. It used to be used to do that with cassettes. And
once
the digital era came around, they said, well, it's, you know, you just do it digitally.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, well, that makes sense. And it's definitely like saves you on postage and actual physical cassette tape.
It's also
discs.
Too much to even, I mean, now maybe not as much, but in the mid-2000s to even... the bandwidth you need from an internet perspective to download that much. You know, I mean, you're talking a hard drive comes to you. That's a terabyte hard drive.
Right.
You know, like back in those, you know, in the 90s or not even 90s, during dial up, you couldn't even do that shit. But, you know, even in the 2000s, you know, like Comcast would be like, fuck you. You're using too much bandwidth.
Right.
Like we're going to
throttle you.
Yeah, exactly. So,
dude, it's funny that you bring up like the internet in like the 90s, because like when we were graduated, when I graduated right before you guys graduated, because Christos is a year younger than I am.
Yes.
That's when really the internet started becoming really the internet that we know and love. And I remember we used to go into Mr. James' office and you would like pull up just weird shit. Like I remember like you pulled up some like 30-second like loop of some dead show and it took
like an hour.
Like it was longer than that. It was like you started downloading it at
the morning.
In the morning, and by like study hall for our student council study hall, it was finally ready. You're like, dude, check this out.
Check it out. The internet's amazing.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah, man.
Oh man.
AOL.
Yeah. And then I cannot unburn that image of corn out of my head, dude. Like seriously. Like so, So Chris and I actually served on student council together.
Uh-huh.
I keep calling you Chris. I'm sorry,
dude. Right.
I know you've been
it's funny, right? I went through I'm not going to call it a transition, but at a certain point in my life, I started going by my first name. But only people who knew me prior to that
Get
the pass.
That's hilarious. Right on. Yeah. I appreciate that.
Yeah.
So we used to have study halls together and went to conventions and stuff like that together. So, like, there's plenty of, there's a lot of history, man. There's a lot of tread under the tires here. But, dude, I remember, it was 97. It was the Illinois State Association of Student Councils convention. I had already graduated. I came back as a guest.
Yeah.
And I crashed in
your
room.
Downtown Chicago,
And, like, I just, there was just I think it was, like, the first night we were there. And we were all just bullshitting, like, late at night, like we usually do. And we're like, all right, fine. The conversation finally ended. And like, there were some girls in the room next to us. And they just jabbering the whole night. And you just screamed at the top of your lungs, "Go to sleep!" Dude, I don't think I've laughed that hard in a very, very long time.
Oh, my God. Yeah, those... It's funny because, you know, in college and later in life, I'll tell people like, oh, yeah, I was really involved in student council in high school.
What?
They're like, what?
Yeah,
I'm like, no, you don't understand. Like,
it was a party.
It's like the people who sat like in the back of the group, you know, for student council. Right. They didn't really get into it. But like if you like really like, quote unquote, got hardcore and were like on the district or in the state, you know, level.
For sure.
That's all it was. I mean, you're talking, you know, a hotel with 3,000 high school kids.
Very minimal supervision.
Very minimal. Very, very minimal supervision. I remember I had my fake ID and I went to the bar, the Berghoff down the street,
right,
you know, and like had a couple of beers and came back to the convention.
Right. And how many times did we like, did we just like skip like entire chunks of the convention and just hang out in Chicago? Go up to the alley.
Yeah.
Like go to the north side and just hang out.
Just like pay somebody on the street to go buy us beer and like sneak it into the hotel.
Right. Right. We get all the cigars.
Yes.
Lots of cigars.
Yes.
We didn't even know what we were doing at that point.
No, we didn't. It was cool, though, right? We're like, yeah,
walking around Grant Park at like 3 o'clock in the morning,
exactly,
smoking cigars, thinking we were cool.
Totally unsupervised.
Dude,
it was awesome.
Absolutely.
It was
You were at the last national convention that I went to as well, the one in Tulsa?
I did not go to Tulsa.
You did not go to Tulsa?
I went to the following. The Tulsa was a year before. I went to the one in Orlando.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
You were not on that one.
No, I had graduated at that point. I was done. Yeah. All right. For some reason, I thought you were on that Tulsa trip. Did you go to Omaha?
Nope.
For the regional?
I did. Yes,
yeah.
I
okay.
Did go,
so
yeah,
we
I
did go to that one.
Yes, yes.
Actually, I reconnected with a gal named Star Kennedy, and like just some chick that I met there. Mm-hmm. Totally cool. And like just a couple weeks back, like or maybe about maybe 6 months ago or so, like I was fucking around on Facebook. I'm like, dude, no wonder. And sure enough, man, she's still out there, got a couple kids and stuff. And so I'm like, fucking A, man. That's so cool. Like you're just random happenstance people that you meet over a weekend and you still still keep in contact with them.
Yeah.
You know, like I still keep in contact with some of the people that I met in Milliken.
Okay.
When I went down to that workshop. Like it's crazy. Like
yeah.
And then there's our advisor.
Walter, what's a pederast?
Donnie, please. All right. How about we put a pin in this, because I'm sure this will be a conversation and a half, and you'll need to refill your drink.
I do need to refill my drink. Caucasian is running dangerously low.
All right. So, yeah, it was, what, a year ago when the info came out?
I'm going to say, yeah, it's probably about a year.
Year,
maybe
year
a little
and
bit
half
more
ago?
Than that. Yeah.
Something like that. So
click on the old Beacon News website.
Yeah. Yeah. Because who sent, was it you?
It was me.
That sent it out
well,
to the.
Yes.
Yeah, because you sent it out to, like, me and Marty and
Noah,
Cooper and
Dan,
Noah.
Yeah, Andrew.
And the old crew.
Right. Yeah.
And then, so basically what had happened was our student council advisor, who was also the algebra teacher.
Some type of math teacher.
At our high school, was caught soliciting a minor.
Something like that, yeah.
And also producing and possessing child pornography.
That didn't come out till later.
Yeah.
Yeah, the whole thing about him with a student.
That was not surprising.
That was, well, I don't know if it was surprise. Yeah, I guess I wasn't surprised. I guess I was more surprised that any student would, like, want to, like, fuck around with him because.
Yeah. Like, he wasn't. But you know what, though? Like, I was telling Kirsten, I'm like, he was that teacher that was always a little too cool.
Right. Definitely made the extra effort to be cool.
Yeah.
Like during, like, our student council / study hall.
He'd always be playing his guitar.
Yeah, his guitar out.
And he was, like the first person I ever met in my life that had a laptop computer.
Yeah, man.
He was
hardcore.
Like, oh, yeah, well, it's got a 26K modem in it. And I'm like, dude, I don't know what that means, but that sounds fucking dope as shit.
Yeah, dude.
You know?
Yeah.
But yeah, like I could, like, just some of the things that I had heard, because even, like, Amy was like, yeah, I used to get creepy notes from him all the time.
Wow. Yeah, see, that doesn't, again, it doesn't surprise me that he would attempt. What surprised me is that somebody would, like,
reciprocate.
Go along with it. Because, yeah, he wasn't, like, a good looking.
No. But the kid's thing.
That
creeped me out.
That was really fucked up.
Yeah.
Right. And according to the news, allegedly, you know, this is still in
right.
court. So it's all allegedly at this point.
Have they found him yet?
No, yeah. I don't
yeah, because he skipped bail.
He skipped bail. He didn't show up to court. And
nope.
They can't find him.
Know,
the judge put a warrant out for him. But yeah, apparently it was a family member, according to the news, that he had whatever child produced and possessed pornography included.
Oh my God.
A family member. So I'm assuming.
See, like, I'd have to stab a bitch.
It's weird. It's
yeah.
Especially for how much time we spent with him. Like when
I would have never.
Which on the side note. Also in the same school, when the band teacher was busted and put in prison for 15 years a couple years ago, that didn't surprise me at all.
Really?
I was not surprised. I was in band, so
I
knew Steve Orland as a teacher and spent time with him. That didn't surprise me. You
right.
know, he was, I would say he was a good-looking guy either, but he was younger, and so I could see it. So, like, all the band nerd girls were, like, totally, like, in love with him, you know?
Yeah.
And I thought it was just a matter of time before he took advantage of that.
True, and he was a nice guy.
Yeah, he was.
Like, he was a legitimately nice guy. Like, I wasn't even in band, and he knew who I was.
I mean, that was his first teaching gig out of college.
Was it
so,
really?
Right, so, I mean, when he started there, he must have been, I'm going to say 24, maybe.
Easily.
You know, so he was young, you know?
Yeah, because he took over for old man Pykel.
That's right.
Yeah, because I know people who went to college with him.
Yeah.
You know, but
it wasn't,
like,
that much older than us.
No.
Realistically. I mean, he's maybe 8 years older than us.
Yeah,
at that time,
yeah, totally.
You know?
But still, it's like, God damn it. You know, it's like, what do you think you're going to get out of that?
I don't know.
Like,
it's not going to end well.
Like, even now, I'm at 40. I look at 20-year-olds and even to an extent 30-year-olds, and I'm like, I don't even want to associate
it
with you.
It's weird.
Like, you speak a totally different language than I do. Like, I don't understand it.
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
It was a couple years ago. Myself and two of my brothers-in-law. I don't know.
Brothers-in-law.
Which word do you make plural?
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Went to.
I think it was to be the brothers.
Brothers-in-law. Yeah, bros. Went to a college football game. One of them had gotten tickets, and it was like good seats, front row, you know, right at like midfield, 50-yard line ish. And the cheerleaders come out, and like I just remember being younger, be like, all right, yeah, the cheerleaders. Like they came out, and we were just like, are these 12? Like what?
Yeah,
the
dude,
it's very different, right?
Seriously,
when you get older, yeah.
Yeah, I was at a thing last night at my church, actually, where it was just a bunch of, it was like a guys get together, but we were doing beers and like appetizers and stuff. And our pastor was there and he's like, dude, so maybe we should check IDs. And I'm like, that might be a good idea if you're serving beer to people.
Yeah, right.
And he's like, well, maybe we could just like, you know, you could get an eyeball. I'm like, dude, no.
It's communion.
Yeah. Well, not even that. It's like, I don't know. I have zero distinction in ages.
Yeah.
Like, you could be 20, you could be 12. I have no idea at this point. Unless you look old like me, I have no idea.
So, right, that's how normal people think.
Right.
Right? And then so when you hear the band teacher was caught in one of the equipment rooms with...
banging a kid!
You know, it's just weird, right? I mean, so that was probably a 15, 16-year-old child.
Oh, yeah.
And it's just like,
it's a child, dude.
It's a child.
Child.
Yeah.
Like, even like, because in this neighborhood, there's a lot of kids in this neighborhood. There's a junior high school just right up the block this way. There's a grade school down the block that way. And then there's a high school just a little further up the way. And even like seeing these high school kids, they don't look much older than like, I don't know, like 14.
Yeah.
I'm 18. Sure you are.
Still. There's no difference.
No.
Yeah.
No.
Still
there's,
a child.
Yeah, seriously. And it's like, how I just... Yeah.
This is weird.
It's weird,
it's
dude.
Just, yeah, the whole thing is just, it's weird and gross.
It's very gross. And just to think that homie was around, like, again, highly unsupervised children.
Yeah, right.
For, like, a decade easily.
Easily, yeah.
You know?
Yeah, yeah. No, you're right. I mean, we would go to Chicago, go to this city, that city, in hotels, and there'd be times where it'd be him and 30 students.
Yeah. Mostly girls.
Right. Oh, mostly.
Which was
absolutely.
Like 90% of the reason why any dude
absolutely.
Got into the,
absolutely.
Like, student council and rock and roll. It's the only two reasons guys get into it is because of girls.
Student council is such an untapped resource.
Oh,
people
dude.
Didn't understand.
Tappa, 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 sir. That was my favorite sorority.
Yeah.
But yeah,
it was so right. So you think about that, and then, you know, you open the paper one day and see that the guy who's, you know, in charge of it all for your school is, you know, going to jail.
Yeah, and it's crazy.
It's fucked up, yeah.
To the point where, like, his son went to...
Yeah.
He graduated with me.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And he did not come to our 20-year anniversary because it happened all around the same time, and I'm sure that the guy just did not want to answer a ton of questions.
Hell no, man.
You know, at all.
Yeah.
At all.
I talked to, through email, but an old friend of ours, Dan, said... I think it was Dan said he sees him every once in a while.
Cooper?
I think it was. Maybe it wasn't. I'm trying to think of who does. Who sees him. My neighbor is Chris Weaver.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Which, you know, another high school.
Seriously, man. I haven't seen Chris in years, man.
Yeah. Officer Weaver.
He's a cop now?
Yeah, man. Yeah.
What?
He's a detective.
Holy shit.
Yeah. But he was really good friends with him.
Really? Yeah, yeah, yeah. They were tight.
And he grew up across the street from him, you know, in their younger years, and you know, so this is the whole thing is just sad.
Yeah,
right? I mean, it's fucked up enough, and you know, and then when your parent is the high school teacher,
yeah,
right, it's the closest you can get to being a public figure
for sure.
You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
It's, so yeah, it just sucks. I can't imagine.
Yeah. Yeah.
What he's, you know, what he's dealing with. But
seriously, dude, it's fucked up. Like, because my mom, like, because it was just a couple weeks ago that they released that he skipped bail.
Yeah, he didn't show up to court.
And my mom's like, she calls me at like 6 o'clock in the morning. It wasn't that early. You know, but she called me. It was pretty early in the morning. She's like, did you know a Robert James? I'm like, yeah. She's like, did you know what he did? I'm like, yeah.
Walter.
Right.
8-year-olds, dude.
8-year-olds, dude. Oh, and then she was like, yeah, he skipped bail. I'm like, what?
Wow.
And then I got on my laptop and I pulled it up and I'm like, holy the shit.
Yeah.
Yeah, dude, that was just.
I'm guessing he left the country.
Oh, yeah.
That's
my
prediction.
He's in Mexico.
Yeah.
For sure. He speaks fluent. Like, he speaks fluent
Spanish.
Well,
right. Was it his wife?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or his ex-wife.
Yeah, well, at this point, I would hope so.
Well, I thought even when we were in school that him and his wife had separated. But maybe
I think
I'm
that's
wrong.
Possible.
I don't remember.
Because I remember hearing rumors that he was, like, dating a girl's mom. I don't know.
See?
Yeah. It's just creepy all the way around. It's like, weird. Just fucking weird, dude. Mm-hmm. But, yeah. Crazy ass shit, man. Oh.
Yeah, two teachers from our high school.
From the same school. Do you think they compared notes?
I don't know.
Like they had a ring?
That's weird.
Like, it's just too weird and too coincidental that it was mm-hmm. two fucking teachers. Mm-hmm. You know? The two hip teachers at that.
Yep.
You know, you're never gonna hear of like Coach Bell. You know?
No.
Maybe Coach J.
Coach J.
Totally.
Right. I definitely heard many.
Oh, yeah.
Alleged
rumors.
Rumors, mm-hmm. right. But.
Dude, have you been by the old. Well, you live not too far from there.
I live not too far. Yeah, I drive by it regularly.
Dude, that building, like, doesn't even resemble what I remember anymore. You know, it's crazy. So. Yeah, but damn, it's fucked up, dude. Like, that's just, I can't get over it.
Yeah.
Like, it's just it's to that, weird. It's just mind-blowing. And now, like, being a dad, like, you know, when you don't have kids and you hear about crazy shit like that happening, you're just like, wow, that's fucked up.
Yeah, my kids are going to go to that school.
Yeah.
You know, that's still my school district.
Right.
So.
But now, as a parent, you're like, dude, I will slip my knife between somebody's ribs. Like,
as a parent, I'm like, oh you want to be a student council? I'm chaperoning
every fucking
trip.
Thing. Absolutely. I will be there. I will be like in the room adjacent to yours. We'll have the open door between the two so I can make sure what's going on.
Exactly.
Especially since you got girls, man.
Holy shit. That's prime target.
Yeah.
I think about that all the time.
Right? Because then we remember how bad we were.
I would. Yeah, absolutely. I know there's more people like me out there, and that's what I'm afraid of most.
Yeah, you turned all right, though, man. You turned out all right.
Right, but back then.
Right. Dude, I think I recall it was before we were out of college. I went down to U of I to see Jack Johnson. And I can't remember if we met up while I was down there. I don't think we did.
I don't think so, but it's, again, it's kind of hazy.
Yeah. Like, dude, we went because it was at the Canopy Club.
Yeah, okay.
And
it's possible. I lived right close to there for a few years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because I think we tried, or you were up here, or you had something going on. But, dude, I passed out in the Canopy Club.
Nice.
Yeah.
I've done that before.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Dude, that place is small.
It's not that,
and hot.
Yes.
Especially if you're sitting in the balcony or the seats up there.
Yes. Yep.
Like, I had Mike from Kiss the Sky, his son, was in a frat down there.
Okay.
And so I stayed at the frat house while I was down there.
Awesome.
And these guys start passing a bong around. Yeah. And this is like back in my prime.
Yep.
And like these kids just couldn't believe it. I was like murdering it at that point. And they're like, how are you still standing? I'm like, professional, man.
Yeah.
You know, I grew up in Aurora. Yeah. What do you expect?
The A-Town Brown.
Right? Seriously. And then like we got up into the, we got to the show. Just pass the fuck out. Like,
that's funny.
20 minutes into the show, I'm like,
yeah.
So,
saw many shows there.
Yeah, it's a cool looking club.
It is a cool place. It used to be a movie theater.
And I could see that.
Yeah,
it
was. It was called the Bruin View. So they always played like older movies.
Sure.
Right, shit from 5-10 years ago or something. Mm-hmm. You know, you could go there and see Stripes or Caddyshack or shit like that. You know, older movies, and it was like $2 to get in, and there was a bar.
Dope.
So you'd get beers and drink and just watch the movie.
Movies.
And so, the balcony, the part that you're talking about,
yeah.
You know, inevitably, like, you know,
somebody's getting laid up there for sure.
Part of going to the Bruin View was you get your toilet paper roll and stuff a dryer sheet in it, you know, and that's, you know, you have your beer and
have a little tug.
Exactly.
That's hilarious.
Yeah.
Yeah,
then they turn into a music venue, which is awesome.
Yeah.
It's a cool place. I saw many shows there. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a cool venue, man. Yeah. Like, and that was like when I was in my like Jack Johnson heyday. Like, dude, I saw him open up for G Love and Special Sauce and became an instantaneous fan.
Yeah, G Love's awesome.
Yeah,
I've seen him at the Canopy Club a couple times.
Yeah,
you come through about once a year down there, at least during those years.
For sure. Yeah, like I saw the last time I saw him, he did his 20th anniversary show in 2014. God damn it, I'm fucking old. Was it 2014? God damn, it's 2018, isn't it? It had to have been 2014. Yeah. It was like 20th anniversary. Yeah, because 1994 was when the first album came out.
Okay.
And he played the Metro, and they did the album from front to back. Yeah, nice. It was cool. It was the first time I've ever seen a band do that before.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, but yeah. But, shit. So, yeah. So, in typical pop goulash fashion,
all right,
what we like to ask each other is, what have you been consuming this week as far as any type of pop cultural stuff, music, movies, games? What have you been into?
Interesting. So, music has not changed for the last 20 years for me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my in my car, I have Sirius. It's either on the Dead Channel or on Howard Stern.
Okay.
As far as movies, God, I haven't seen a new movie in a long time. The movies that I see now are either Disney Pixar stuff or whatever shit my kids are into.
Right. Hey, you haven't gone with Abby to go see any of the Star Wars
Yeah,
films
we have. Then? Yeah, of course. Of course.
So, Christos's wife is an avid Star Wars fan.
Huge.
Huge. Yeah. Like, and when she, like, when I found that out about her, I was like, really? I never knew. Because, I knew Abby in high school.
Yeah, it's funny because I didn't.
Right. Like, I knew her in high school, and I was like, oh, that's interesting. Like, I never knew that about her.
No, she is a huge Star Wars fan.
Yeah.
So, yeah, so I've been, you know, I go to those, and I enjoy it. I'm just not...
That's not your
a
thing.
...a nerd like she is. But TV shows, God, I just feel like, in general, I'm, like, very old school. Like, I always, like... If you want to know what I really watch, I don't really watch. The only thing that I'm watching new now actively is the new Roseanne reboot.
Is it good?
I like it.
I've heard it's been, it's gotten a lot of good ratings.
Yeah, I haven't seen this week's episode. It's still on the DVR. My wife is traveling for work, so we got to catch up. We kind of save them,
right,
you know? But I've been happy with it so far. But I watch a lot of the old Roseanne reruns.
Sure.
Like on TV Land or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
All in the Family. I fucking
really?
Watch that. It's on my DVR. See, I just feel like I don't have time. You know? Like, I have a hard time committing to a new show. Like, I can only handle one new show at a time. Because, like, otherwise it just sits on the DVR.
Dude, I get you.
You know?
Dude,
I actually really enjoy, and I'm behind on a few episodes in this season, but Baskets on FX.
You know, Dana, my podcast co-host, is like, dude, you need to watch the show. I'm like,
Baskets?
Yeah.
It's awesome.
She loves it.
It is really good.
Right.
Louis Anderson.
I hear he's amazing in it.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. I honestly, Zach Galifianakis is awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Like, he's like the main character on the show.
Louis's the star.
Louis Anderson is a star. And he's already won Emmys.
He won an Emmy for it,
He won an Emmy for it.
And he basically plays himself in a dress.
He plays a fat old lady.
Right.
But the way he does it is uncanny. It's amazing. Mm-hmm. It's like, you know, it's a man, but, like, I don't know how he does it. Like, that was a well-deserved Emmy because I can't stop laughing whenever he's on the screen.
Really?
It's awesome. It's awesome.
Because they're, what, 3 seasons in now?
Yeah, this is season 3, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. It's a great show. It's really funny.
Yeah, it's one of those that I'll eventually end up catching up on. I just have never had a chance to.
I recommend it. I recommend it. Let's see, what else? So that's movies, games. You said games?
Yeah, whatever, man.
Oh, yeah. I am addicted to Clash Royale.
What is that?
It's a game that teenagers play.
Is that one of those phone games? Yeah. Is that the one that...
It's a game normally played indoors by 12-year-olds.
Is that the one that... what's her name? Not Brooklyn Decker. What was the... what was the hot model with the big tits? What was her name?
I don't know.
Oh, it's right at the tip of my brain. I think Mariah Carey did some ads for it too.
No, not this.
No,
or
am I thinking Clash of Clans?
Clash of Clans was the original game, and then they did like a spinoff, right? So it's funny how video games have spinoffs now,
right?
You know, but I've totally been into that for probably about 2 years now.
Really,
I spent way too much time.
That's hilarious. Is it like one of those like RPGs or
no? It's It's funny. The way I think about it is, and my wife plays it now as well. Unfortunately, we're both into it. So it's like whatever time we have without kids, like we're just on our phones playing.
That's pretty much.
But I would equate it to a video game version of, like, I think I've never played Magic the Gathering,
mm-hmm.
but I think of it the same way. There's different characters and they each have different powers. And
yeah.
So, but essentially it's like mini games. They're 3 minute long games.
Mm-hmm.
You have your people, your army that you play with, and you're fighting against somebody else. And the objective is to destroy each other's towers.
Sure.
Yeah. So it's an addictive game because it's only 3 minutes long. So
sure.
You're somewhere waiting in line, or hey, I'm waiting for him to call my name for whatever.
Right.
You can whip out a game or two, you know?
Nice.
So it's like, it's not like you have to sit there for hours and hours and hours, which mm-hmm. sometimes that happens.
Oh,
because
yeah.
You just sit there and just play. But yeah, it's a love-hate thing. I've wasted
sure.
so much time, and I feel like I don't have time in my life in general.
Yeah.
But for some reason, I'm able to waste time on this.
Yeah, I'm totally the same way. Like, by the time, like, 9 times out of 10, like, I've got a DVR full of stuff that I just,
yeah.
I love,
never
but
get
I can't
to.
Get to it.
They'll never get to it.
Because, you know, like, my wife's not into my shit.
Yeah.
So, like, if we're watching TV,
right.
like, we'll watch what she's watching yep. just because I know she's not going to want to watch my shit.
Mm-hmm.
And, or, like, we'll have time. But I'm passed out because
exactly.
I get up at like 5:30 in the morning,
exactly.
6 o'clock in the morning to
yeah.
start getting stuff ready for the, you know, for the day. And the next thing you know, the kids are like, you know, the kids are waking up and,
yep.
you know, you get stuck watching Paw Patrol for 2.5 hours. So,
yeah.
Yeah.
I can relate.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, I'm not a big, you know, as far as like pop culture, like what I think of pop culture, like I'll be at work or even my wife or siblings or whatever. Oh yeah. Like so-and-so they'll throw out names and it's like, I don't know who that is. Like,
yeah.
should I know that person? Like I don't know, you know, or I'll see somebody on TV. I'm like, oh yeah. Like so-and-so, like they were good. You know, I
yeah.
like that commercial. Whatever. Like, oh yeah, that's blah, blah, blah. I'm like, I don't know
okay.
who that is.
Right.
Like, is that important? I don't know.
Seriously, it's like I posted up on Twitter a few years back. It's like I knew that I was a successful adult when I walked through the grocery store, got to the tabloid section, and I had no idea who any of the people were on the cover of it.
I'm terrible with names in general.
Mm.
So it's like, and then these people are not important to me.
Right.
So.
For sure. Like I got such limited space in my brain right,
right.
now.
I'm like something, I'm going to have to like forget something important in order for me to remember this
right.
fucking moron.
God damn. There are so many morons.
There's,
fucking...
there's an abundance. Mm-hmm. Definitely an abundance.
Right.
So, what else? Yeah, I don't know. I mean, it's.
Well, like if you're, I know you said that you usually spin the, you're on Sirius Radio
mm-hmm.
in the car.
Yep.
But if you're popping in, what was the first album what was the last album you listened to beginning to end?
Huh.
Or live show for that matter.
Yeah. You know, there, every once in a while, at home, I'm going to say a small percentage of some of my live recordings that I've done personally up on my Google account.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so every once in a while I'll bust something out there, and it's usually a lot of times it's a Mr. Blotto show or that I've recorded, or there's another band that I'm really into that I got hip to when I was in upstate New York called Dawn of the Buffalo.
Okay.
And God, I love them. Anybody who's into, I'm trying to think how I would categorize their music. They call themselves Americana.
Okay.
But they definitely have like a kind of like a Zydeco influence to it.
Ooh.
Which
okay.
is, but it's just to me, like to me, like that, they do it for me.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And so they come to Chicago like once a year.
Yeah.
Which for me is not enough.
Right.
And honestly, it's one of those things when they do come, I have to go. And sometimes my wife will come with me, and if she can't, then it's like, I have to go.
Right.
Because
we'll see
it. It really, it's for me, that music just, it just recharges me,
mm-hmm.
you know? And so a lot of times I'll pick up some, I've done many recordings. So when I lived in upstate New York, they were based out of, you know, their home base was 10 minutes from where I lived, you know?
Right.
So I would see them constantly, you
Very
know?
Cool.
But
it's crazy that a band with Zydeco influence would be coming out of upstate New York.
It's very interesting. But I mean, so yeah, they you know, their music has kind of a broad range. But sure. You know, the lead singer Taryn Evans, she's awesome. She will play acoustic guitar.
Mm-hmm.
She'll play an accordion. She'll bust out a violin and just rock it.
Right on.
And then she'll put on a scrub board and play the spoons. You mm-hmm. know, it's really cool. Like that, it's the kind of music where I don't care who you are, when you're listening to it,
makes your ass move.
You can't sit still.
Nice.
You either start tapping your hand, tapping your foot, or mm-hmm. you know, you just can't sit still listening sure. to that kind of music.
And right
it,
on.
It just gets you going. You know.
Nice.
So, yeah, I'll listen to that. So as far as the last album I listened to from start to finish, you know, recently we got hooked up with a Spotify premium account.
Sure. So you can actually listen to an album.
Exactly. And so so when you're saying the last album that I listened to from start to finish, I actually listened to Bob Marley's Exodus, probably about 2 weeks ago.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Wow. It's a good album.
It just came out of nowhere.
Sure. You're like, well, what the fuck?
Yeah.
Why not?
Yeah.
Very cool.
So
very cool.
But going back to the, you know, to the Mr. Blotto discussion, my wife and I have been to, every summer, they do their own festival called
yep.
Blotopia.
Mm-hmm.
And part of the deal is it's two nights. They play, you know, they play both nights, but on the second night they do a show. So two sets, encore. But for the encore, they do a full album.
Okay.
But you never know what it's going to be.
Kind of like Fish's.
Kind of. What they do for Halloween.
Halloween.
Yeah, yeah. Same concept. And
sure.
So one of the years we went. They did Babylon by Bus.
Okay.
From start to so it's cool. It's
yeah, yeah.
You go there and you know, I've seen them do Bob Marley. One year they did Pink Floyd Animals.
Okay.
Which is awesome.
Thank God they didn't do Dark Side of the Moon. I'm tired of bands covering Dark
I know.
Side of the Moon.
It's been overdone.
Absolutely.
But Animals is an amazing album. One year
Animals
they did
incredible.
Toys in the Attic, Aerosmith.
Really?
Yeah. So it's
oh
it's,
dude,
it's,
I would have paid good money
yeah,
to see Blotto
awesome.
Do Toys in the Attic.
One year they did a Talking Heads album.
Really?
Awesome. So it's very it isn't just like jam bands that they will
yeah,
try
yeah.
and cover, you know.
That's cool that they're stretching out, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Especially like, damn, fucking Toys in the Attic is one of those kick-ass albums, dude.
It
like,
was. It was awesome.
Like, I am yeah. such, I was, you know, it's no, it's not a secret that I am a huge Aerosmith fan, and I always have been.
Yeah.
Like, ever since I was a kid.
How
like,
can you not? You don't have to be a huge Aerosmith fan, but everybody loves Aerosmith.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's a shame to see Steve Tyler go the way of a country band, so. Like, why? Dude, he's playing Ribfest this year.
Are you serious?
Yes.
Wow, that's sad.
With his country band.
That's kind of sad.
Yeah.
Yeah. Ribfest.
Seriously. It's like, awesome. I expect, like, when they're like, Joan Jett and, you know, ZZ
yeah,
Top,
yeah.
I anticipate
yeah,
that.
Yeah,
but, like,
yeah.
Steve, like, Aerosmith can still sell out arenas, man.
Yeah.
Like,
oh, yeah.
Seriously. But, like, yeah, I'm a huge Aerosmith fan, and god damn that Toys in the Attic. Like, their
yeah.
first, like, four albums were just...
Yeah.
Like
fire!
Oh my god, dude! Yeah. Ridiculous!
Have you ever caught any shows at River Edge Park in Aurora?
I have not yet.
Yeah.
No,
it's a great venue, man.
I've heard it's an awesome venue. I wanted to see Kesha there last year.
Okay,
because like I'm not a fan of like Kesha's first two records. It's like Euro trash pop dance stuff. She put out this album last summer called Rainbows. Holy the shit, dude!
Good,
dude. Yeah, like she's got. Three country songs on the record. She's got like two songs that she does with Eagles of Death Metal, who are like,
yeah,
one of my favorites. Like,
okay.
I dig Eagles of Death Metal a lot. And then, like, the rest of the album, like, she has a song with the Dap Kings horn section. Are you familiar
yeah,
with
yeah,
Sharon
yeah.
Jones
yeah,
and
yeah.
the Dap Kings? I went with Jasper Neela and Ann Wolf and Ziggler. To go see
yeah.
Sharon Jones and the Dap Kings at the Double Door.
Okay.
It was the last time I ever went to the Double Door. Dude, she was amazing.
Interesting.
Amazing. Like, RIP, though, man. It's sad.
I know nothing of Kesha.
Kesha, yeah, I mean.
I just know that she uses, like, a dollar sign to, like,
yeah,
spell her name.
Yeah, she dropped that a few years back, but,
okay.
But like, this new album.
I thought she was, is she, like, hip-hop? Like, what?
No. Like I said, it was, like, Eurotrash dance.
Like, Autobahn? From
we believe in nothing.
She a nihilist or? I've heard that's pretty exhausting.
Right? I mean, say what you will about the
tenets of national socialism,
but at least it's an ethos.
Fuck me.
But yeah, no, she's but no, it's just like dance music. Like her first two albums were just pretty much really synth heavy dance music.
Interesting.
But this album, she finally got control over it.
Okay.
And she's been writing for artists left and right.
Oh, really?
Like, yeah, like she's a really talented songwriter.
Interesting.
And she actually does a Dolly Parton cover on this album with Dolly Parton.
Cool.
Dude, the album.
I like stuff like that.
Dude, the
That's
album.
Cool.
Yeah, the album's phenomenal. It's,
when you have like such an established, like iconic artist who's willing to
just come out and.
Right. Like, like they wouldn't do that unless they felt. That person that they're doing it with was
sure, yeah, absolutely
worthy. Quote,
yeah,
you know
like
what I mean,
for
whatever,
sure,
whatever their definition of worthy is.
Absolutely, but. I mean, it would be one thing for her to just be like, "Yeah, go ahead, cover it. I'll collect a royalty
yeah,
check."
Exactly. Yeah.
But to actually appear on the song
yep.
with her,
yep.
Fuck yeah, dude.
Yeah.
So yeah, her Rainbows album is just stellar, dude.
Cool.
And when I had some people that would pop up that on my Facebook feed and stuff, they're like, "This new Kesha album." I'm like, "Really? It's Kesha."
Yeah,
like really, Kesha? Seriously, like the TikTok? Really? No,
no.
And then I finally buckled down because I subscribed to Apple Music because it's on my phone. I'm like,
yeah.
And I listened to it. I'm like, God damn it, this album is fucking incredible.
Cool.
It's a great fucking record.
That's nice.
Yeah. So that's
you know, I.
But she played there. She was supposed to play at River's Edge last summer.
Right, she was. And it got canceled.
And it got canceled
yeah,
for
yeah.
the rain
yeah,
from
yeah,
rain,
yeah.
and
right.
like everybody lost their shit about it.
Yeah,
and people are still waiting to get the refunds back for their money.
It's a cool venue.
Yeah,
yeah. Like even if it's like a band that you're like, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
It's just cool to go. It's cool that it's in Aurora too.
Right.
And they actually, every year they're bringing bigger and bigger names. Which
they got
I think
Kiss
is
last
yeah,
year,
which I think is awesome.
Yeah. Like I mean, look, Kiss is just a step away from the State Fair circuit, as far as I'm concerned at this point. But
yes,
but
agree.
Still, they
totally
got
agree.
Kiss in
yeah.
makeup to perform there, you know, which is pretty dope. You know,
isn't it sad? Like, how old is Gene Simmons now?
Dude, he's like 143. He's older than Moses.
He's got to feel like a little bit of an asshole, like on stage running around in makeup.
I don't think he does. I don't think he has that. Like, I don't think that he has hit that point of
yeah.
of. He's not humble. That's
yeah.
the thing. He's
he
just like
a shit.
I'm Gene Simmons, and yeah. I make
yeah.
a lot of money. I have Kiss condoms now.
That's,
like, dude,
yeah.
Kiss.
Yeah, they got their name on everything.
Everything.
Yeah.
Dude,
yeah.
there's a Kiss coffin that you can
oh, yeah,
buy.
Yeah, yeah, I've seen that.
And it doubles as a beer cooler, or it doubles as a cooler until you die. I'm like, that's, dude. People bought it.
Oh, yeah.
People bought it.
They're retarded.
Yeah, well, yeah. They're Kiss fans. I mean.
No, they're retarded.
Yeah. But yeah, it's a cool venue. I'm waiting to see what the lineup this year is.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I don't know if we can get an opportunity and it's something that might be decent enough to take the kids to or something
yeah.
that's
yeah.
tame enough to take the kids
yeah.
to. Yeah, why not? Like
it's a nice, big, wide open space.
Mm-hmm.
I saw, I've only been there once.
Yeah.
We got hooked up, a buddy of mine. Their business sponsors them, so they
sure.
they get tickets, you know, for shows, and they hooked us up with tickets to a Dark Star.
Yeah, I saw Dark Star played there.
Yeah, yeah, we went to that show.
Are they still doing the we pick a show and play the entire show from front to back?
Yep. Yes, as far as I know.
Mm-hmm.
However, I think that they kind of will do their own sets every once in a while.
Sure.
But
because that was their
and that lineup has changed too.
Has it
over the years? I mean, John. I do a terrible job of pronouncing his last name, but John Kladisek or something. He, at some point, he was the guy who played the Jerry spot for many years. And I'd seen him many times perform, you know, with Dark Star. And it's funny because, you know, they pick different shows, right?
Right.
That we did the 1972 at the Orpheum, whatever. You know?
Right.
There are certain eras of Jerry where he. Because Jerry's voice evolved over the years, just like
mm-hmm.
any other singer. But there are certain eras where when he was doing Jerry in that era, you could close your eyes and like, wow.
Really?
It was very, you know, it was that fucking good. And his guitar playing was good. So mm-hmm. he actually hooked up with Bob Weir and them and played, I'm trying to think what iteration. I don't think it was As the Dead. Because when they played As the Dead, Warren Haynes from Government Mule was
yeah.
playing with them. But it was another iteration. But I'd seen it, so I mean, it was good enough to where Bob Weir, you know, was like, "Hey, come join us," you know.
Sure.
So, But yeah, so that was a good show at River's Edge. That's nice. The only one I went to, but it's a cool venue. It
right.
really is.
It well,
really
it's is. Cool that they finally have like a decent venue downtown Aurora. I mean, like, you know, the Roundhouse is cool. It's an okay venue to go see a show. And that and the beer is pretty decent when you're there.
Yeah.
But I know Steve from Kiss the Sky is actually gutting a building downtown Aurora right now to turn it into a music venue.
A music place, yep.
Yeah.
I've seen that in the paper, yeah.
Yeah.
The paper, on the internet. I mean,
yeah, right.
Nobody gets a paper anymore,
but yeah. But yeah, but it was crazy because, like, I was just down at Kiss the Sky last week or 2 weeks ago or so, and Mike was telling me about it. I'm like, where's Steve? He's like, I don't know. He's probably up to his elbows in bullshit, like, plaster and whatnot. I'm like, really, what's going on? He was telling me the story about what's going on about this new music venue that's going to be going in downtown.
Yeah. It's like a venue. I don't know if they're going to have they're not going to do like lessons there or anything. But
no,
yeah, it's
so.
More of a, but from my understanding, it's like a smaller place for people to be able to perform and which
right.
is awesome. I mean, I don't know. I mean,
more of an intimate venue.
Downtown Aurora is such a struggle to get anything going there.
Sure.
You know, and so River Edge is awesome.
Mm-hmm.
So anything that's going to help
bring
awesome music closer to me, like, absolutely.
For sure.
I'm in. You know?
Well, I mean, when we were growing up, downtown Aurora was a place you wouldn't go to.
No.
At all.
There's nothing
no,
there.
No, there was the library. That was it.
Library. Well, there used to be like a music store right downtown around the corner from where the old Wabansi was.
Okay.
Studio 7.
Studio 7.
Studio
7.
That's where I bought my bass amp.
I bought a guitar from Studio 7 back in the day.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
But yeah, God, I haven't thought about Studio 7 in years. But yeah, so they're.
Speaking of buying guitars, I remember. So I quote unquote, a bass player, right?
Like, sure.
I haven't picked it up in a while, but the first time my first bass guitar that I bought. Was you hooked me up, you connected me with somebody.
Okay.
Who, it was definitely you. You're like, yeah, I know a dude who has like a bass guitar. He's looking to sell it.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, whatever. So he comes, he knocks on my door, my parents' house in Santucci. And he was a pretty interesting looking character. Had a shitty bass. And
really?
And a little fucking tiny little amp, you know, like, which wasn't even meant to play a bass through. And I bought it for $50 and a bag of some like really shitty weed. So.
Oh, that's hilarious.
I mean, it was definitely somebody that you.
It had to have been somebody that I knew.
Yeah, somebody you knew. You're like, you like made the, you know, like introduce us, but like, hey, like, hey, my buddy wants to buy it, whatever. So just go here at this time and whatever. And so.
That had to have been post high school for sure.
And the bass and the amp just like reeked of like cigarette smoke.
Oh,
like,
my God.
Like, so I brought it in the house. My mom was like, you're not keeping that in this house. Like,
that's hilarious.
Stinks.
God, I'm trying to think of who that was.
I don't know. He's definitely looked like he hung out on Smoker's Corner.
It probably did.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I was rather the butterfly. I could hang out with anybody, so.
But once I played that for a little while, and once I ran into a little bit more money, went to Studio 7, bought a nice amp.
Mm-hmm.
Nice. As a, you know,
a better amp.
Better amp, yeah.
For sure. We all graduate on to bigger and betters. So.
And then a year after that, I went to Hicks Brothers and bought my Ibanez 5-string. And it's been sitting in the caves ever since.
Yeah, dude, I haven't. I really haven't played my guitars since probably right before Grayson was born. Like, I'll fiddle with that one there every now and again, but like, I just don't have time.
My wife, before we were married, bought me for my birthday 1 year a banjo.
Oh, really?
And because I also love bluegrass.
Mm-hmm.
Love bluegrass music.
You know who's an amazing banjo player?
Who?
Steve Martin.
Yeah. Yeah, he's good. He's really good. Yeah,
and he and Rick Moranis.
Rick Moranis. No kidding.
Tour.
Really?
And do a musical tour. Yeah.
Interesting.
Because both of them pretty much dropped out of comedy and focused on music.
You mean Vince Clortho, Gozer the Gozerian?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Nice.
Yeah, they've both started focusing on music, and Rick Moranis has like 4 or 5 country albums out.
Nice.
Like, little weirdo Canadian kid, like, putting out country records. It's rad.
Interesting.
Yeah.
I had no idea.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I got into banjo for a little while, took lessons for a couple years, and I
really?
Was okay, mm-hmm. okay, you know, and then, you know, as you know, life.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I got a bass and a banjo that...
Sit in the case.
Yeah, however, so my wife, I don't know, to this day, I don't know how she got a hold of this banjo, but it's an older banjo. It's from the 70s.
Okay.
For sure. As far as I can tell from the research I've done on it, it's not like a name brand. It's like something out of Japan.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a sticker on the back of the headstock of a music shop out in California.
Okay.
In the San Francisco area. Not San Francisco, but like in the, it's like Palo Alto or something.
Sure.
And once you gave it to me as a gift, I looked at it and I recognized the name right away. That is a music store that Jerry Garcia used to teach guitar lessons at.
Really?
Back in the 60s and very know, late cool. 60s. Yeah.
That's awesome,
so at
man.
Some point, that banjo made its way through that shop.
That's
which I was
awesome.
Like, that's amazing. And she had no idea.
But right.
Like, I saw it right away. I was like, oh, it's fucking cool.
That's crazy. Yeah.
And, so, and Jerry Garcia was a banjo player back in the day.
Right. Yeah. Well, his old in the way stuff is amazing.
Amazing.
Yeah. Like, dude, like... I'm not, like, a huge live Dead fan.
Sure.
But when they're on album, mm-hmm. and they had a producer to tell them, okay, stop.
Yeah.
Like, American Beauty and Working Man's Dead, dude, you don't
Working
get...
Working Man's Dead is an awesome album.
You don't get and much better than
it's
that.
It's funny. I the copy of Working Man's Dead that I own, Marty gave it to me.
Seriously?
Like, somebody had gifted it to him for mm-hmm. Christmas. So
and he's like, I don't listen to the fucking Dead.
He's like, I don't want this. You want it? I'm like, yeah, absolutely. And, yeah, that's a great album.
But, yeah. Those two albums, like, because mm-hmm. they came out back to back.
They did.
And, like, you just, if you're looking for good Americana music,
yeah,
like, it doesn't get better yeah. than that.
That's funny, because that's how I feel about Fish. Like,
yeah.
I'm not a Fish, like, I, you know, Jam On is on
sure.
my presets for Sirius.
Yeah.
But, like, I don't seek out listening to Fish,
mm-hmm.
like, on a day-to-day basis.
Sure.
But you go see him live. It's amazing.
Yeah, absolutely.
In my opinion, as far as sound quality, as a taper, sound quality mm-hmm. of their shows, if you're in the pavilion of any of their shows, that is, they are the best.
Yeah.
I mean, as far as like whatever equipment they use, however they mix it, whatever, like sound quality perspective,
yeah.
it's amazing.
Yeah.
When I saw Grateful Dead, not Grateful Dead, when I saw... the Grateful Dead reunion, so to speak, the GD50
sure.
at Soldier mm-hmm. Field a couple years ago.
Well, that was also Soldier Field, and that place sucks.
It does. That was awesome, too. However, I really feel like every Fish show I've been to, the sound quality is it's amazing. I mean,
it's impeccable.
And I've seen Fish in multiple venues.
Sure.
Outdoor, indoor. Yeah. I saw them at, down at U of I. I'm drawing a blank. What's the venue? The stadium.
The big there. Arena?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I went there for 5 years, and I can't remember the fucking name of the venue.
I know Foo Fighters just played there recently.
Yeah, but regardless of the venue, Fish is, like, their sound quality and their mix is top-notch.
Yeah.
Top-notch.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Absolutely. As well as their light show.
Yes.
Dude, they have one of the most amazing light shows I have ever seen in my life.
Yes. Oh, my God.
And I've seen Fish both stoned out of my gourd and sober as a judge. And still,
yeah.
their yeah. light show is incredible.
Yeah. I gotta say, one of the coolest. So at down at UVI, at one of the shows there at the arena. Why am I drawing a blank on that arena? It's gonna make me crazy.
The Fighting Illini arena,
yeah, something. So we had eaten some mushrooms earlier in the
day. As all good stories start yeah. off with,
which actually doesn't pertain to this specific story, but. It was right at the beginning of the show. So, like, they come out, they're playing whatever song they're playing, and all of a sudden, Trey's guitar goes out.
Really?
And he's, like, fiddling with it, and he keeps singing, but he's, like, you know, messing, whatever. He's, like, doing the foot pedals, like, nothing's working.
Mm-hmm.
He goes back and looks at his stack. You know, it's a stack of amps and all the processors and
sure.
all that. He looks at it, and, like, it's not right. He's obviously visibly frustrated, takes, like, 4 steps back and starts running and, like, kicks it. Like a flying kick, like physically jumps in the air and kicks it. Nothing happens.
Whoa.
Pissed off. Does it again. Nothing. He does it the third time. he kicks it, and as he kicks it, it starts falling back, and the roadie was right back there and catches it. But as he kicked it the third time, and meanwhile, the whole time he's doing this, he's still playing,
mm-hmm.
just in case it comes back on. And
right.
the third kick he did, it just cut back in.
Really?
And he was just fucking wailing a solo, you know?
That's hilarious.
It was, and on mushrooms, I was like, blew my mind.
Yeah.
And then he rocks back up to the microphone, and he says, sometimes you just got to kick it. And the crowd just goes wild, you know?
That's hilarious, those are the
cool
dude.
Moments, you know?
Dude, yeah, absolutely. And it's, that's the thing with live music,
yeah.
is that, like, you get instances exactly like that.
Shit goes wrong.
Yeah.
And that makes it that much cooler.
Yeah. Well, it's like I've got a CD with Henry Rollins doing spoken stuff. Like, I don't like the Rollins band. Like, okay. it's his music just sucks. I'm sorry. Henry will never listen to this, but I was never a fan of his music. Same thing with, like, Black Flag and all the other punk stuff that he did. I'm just not into what he did musically.
Yeah.
But he's a wise guy. Like, he knows his shit. And he did this entire bit about how nothing can truly go wrong on stage. Like, he was touring with Cypress Hill.
Nice.
And, like, he's like, yes, one day something happened. The DAP machine just went down. And B-Real's like, oh, man. Everybody, we fucked up. All right, everybody say, Cypress Hill, y'all fucked up. And the whole crowd's like, Cypress Hill, y'all fucked up.
Yeah.
And he's like, there's nothing can go wrong up
yeah.
here. Like,
yeah.
you just got to own it.
You just make it.
Yeah.
Make it fun.
Yeah, absolutely.
I tell you what, man. I went to a show last year via my wife. It's a band that she's into that I was aware of. Was never really into them.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't really know anything about them, but I actually went to one of their shows. Insane Clown Posse.
Yes.
Have you been to one of their shows?
I have been to one of their shows.
Right, so you've been soaked in Faygo.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. That was. I was completely blown away by the whole thing.
Dude, you know what? Their music sucks, but they have an amazing yeah. fucking show.
Yeah. And you know, my wife and one of my brother-in-laws, they're both into them. And so
I can't believe your wife is a juggalo. Oh, that blows my mind, dude.
Yeah, she's a huge ICP fan. Huge.
Where'd you guys go see them at?
Some fucking random venue, like, in the suburbs.
Really?
So, and that in of itself was a very interesting experience for me. So, yeah, so I've heard them just
sure.
through my wife and my brother-in-law. We'll hang out and... Once they have a few drinks, so yeah, well, inevitably at some point ICP gets put on the stereo, you know,
for sure.
And so their tickets are coming out. You're like, all right, let's go. I'm like, yeah, I'll go. She's like, she had never been to see them, you know, live.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think she had. And so no, she hadn't. And so we're like, yeah, I'll go, you know. And so I knew that, yeah, they, you know, they'll toss around some Faygo and, like, you know, but I had no idea the magnitude.
Yeah, dude.
So we walk into the venue, and there is black plastic from floor to ceiling.
Everywhere.
And I'm like, is this going to be a fucking murder scene? Like, what's going on here, you know?
It's like, are we going to see Gallagher? Is he an opening act?
Yeah, I felt like people are going to die here tonight, you know? And it's like, they just don't want blood everywhere. But the show starts, and God. And so after the fact... So during the show, I was just completely, my mind could not comprehend how many 2 liters of bottles of Faygo they went through.
Oh, yeah.
So afterwards, I did some Googling, and so the statistic is, you know, they go through between 450 and 600 bottles, 2 liter bottles of Faygo per show.
What?
So from being at the show, I'm like, yep. That makes sense
uh-huh.
because I fucking saw it.
Yeah.
Like, it's like you walk out of it. Like, so, like, lesson learned. If
yeah.
you ever go to ICP, bring a change of clothes before
Seriously.
You get back in your car because it's.
You're going to get fucked.
It's a fucking mess.
Yeah.
Wear Dude. Clothes you don't give a shit about.
Right. Dude, did they put on makeup when they went?
Of course.
That's hilarious.
Of course.
Yeah.
Talk about, like, 40, 50 people in their 40s. Like,
right.
Like, Gene Simmons is still doing it.
I know. Why not?
How come Violent J and
Shaggy Too Dope
can't do it?
Yeah. I saw ICP, I want to say maybe... 99, 2000. I don't know exactly when it was. I got the ticket stub somewhere. But I saw him in Peoria.
Nice.
At some, like, little shit venue. Like,
it's always a shit venue.
Yeah.
Because it's going to get destroyed.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, it was... it was amazing. Like, at one point, one of them just picked up a case of 2 liter bottles, which is 6 2 liter bottles
yes.
in a case. not even open. They just took the whole case and just threw it into the crowd.
Yeah.
Like, I'm pretty sure somebody got knocked the fuck out.
Oh, easily.
Like, you know, like somebody got domed. Like, and then, like, 2 minutes later, like, you see, like, in that area, like, just,
like just exploding.
Popping them, yeah,
oh, yeah.
You know? It was insane.
Yeah.
The whole thing was, I mean, as a band, it was, I was just blown away. I'm like, mm-hmm. wow. I just cannot believe, like, you know, there's people on stage whose job it is to just keep bringing out more Faygo.
Yeah.
You know, that's all they do all show long.
Seriously, I wonder if they keep Faygo afloat.
It's funny you say that because, you know, I love researching. And so I looked into it. And at one point, Faygo had tried to file a cease and desist on ICP to
really?
Stop using because they don't want to be associated with
ruffians.
You know, yeah. Well, I think they fucking quickly realize that the only reason they're still in business
is because of the ICP.
It's because of them, and that just kind of went away.
Yeah.
You know? But it's like, yeah, nobody fucking buys Faygo.
No.
You can't even find it anywhere.
Dude, yes, you can. It's a Dollar General, and it's $1 a 2-liter bottle, dude. That shit is bullshit pop, dude.
The only place I've seen is at Woodman's.
Really?
In Aurora.
That's hilarious.
That's the only place. But it's like, yeah, beyond that.
Yeah, it's 99 cents for a 2-liter. It's disgusting.
It's a Michigan, like Detroit thing. I think you see it more
absolutely.
Out there, and that's where they're from. But it's like, yeah, you know. So if they're doing 450 to 600 bottles per show, and they're doing how many shows a year?
Yeah,
I gotta feel like that's a pretty significant, like,
dude. They have to bring like a semi trailer full.
Oh yeah, go on YouTube, dude. There's
ridiculous.
Videos. Ridiculous. There's videos of them like loading semi trucks full of Faygo just to go on tour.
Yeah, that's nuts.
I guarantee you, it's a hell of a lot more than what they're selling at Dollar General.
Oh, for sure. But you gotta think too, like, can you think of another act that has like a product tie-in like that?
No.
Like, really? Like, I can't think of anything in recent memory that's like, I'm going to associate this with this band.
No.
Yeah.
No.
It's nuts. It's absolutely
it's
nuts.
It's shitty pop, too. Like, nobody fucking drinks it for real. Like, people drink it as a joke. Like, I'll buy it every once in a while as a joke.
I can just see your daughter's like, the fuck is this, Dad?
Not even that. It's like if I'm hanging out, like, with my brother-in-law, who's an ICP fan, like, where, you know, for our families are hanging out. Like, every once in a while, I'll be at Woodman's. I'll be like, hey, I'm going to get a bottle of Faygo root beer.
Right.
Like, as a joke.
Right.
You know? Like, nobody drinks it for real.
No. It's disgusting. I think maybe I may have had a Faygo once in my entire life. And maybe that was because it landed in my mouth at the ICP show.
Right. Oh. So the big question is, you go to an ICP show, it's like, which one is it? Because they do the whole show with the same. So it's like, the one that I went to was cola,
mm-hmm.
right? My wife and my brother-in-law went to another show that I wasn't able to go to, and it was, I think it was like root beer.
Yeah.
And it's like, the whole place smells. It's like,
right.
And they use the same pop, the same flavor the whole show. So,
right.
Am I going to come home reeking of?
Seriously. I don't even remember what it was the night that I went.
Yeah.
Like, but yeah, you would almost have to do it that. Yeah,
it's a
sticky
mess.
And just imagine having to drive home from Peoria.
It was crazy. And so, yeah. So once the show was done and people cleared out of the venue, it was like standing water of like just pop and like just like hundreds of like empty 2-liter bottles. And so people who worked there were like had the big squeegee mops and just like, I don't know how the fuck you clean that up. It's
right.
Like, I feel like they never play the same venue twice.
I don't think they can. Maybe
the
that's why they keep
like,
playing shit
like,
venues.
We'll fucking, you know, we'll put up black plastic. It'll be fine. And then once they see it, they're like, yeah, you're never coming back here.
Yeah. Soon they're going to be just playing like VFW halls and the American Legion.
Places that are already sticky.
Seriously. It's like I saw Veruca Salt a few years back up in Milwaukee and they played this like weird VFW hall. I'm like, I could see NSYNC Clown Posse playing this venue because it was just the weirdest fucking venue.
It's a piece of shit.
Yeah. Great show, but it was a piece of shit venue.
Yeah.
And like right across the street is like the Bradley Center or whatever the big place in Milwaukee is. But yeah, it's like, God damn it, man. But yeah, that's bizarre, man. I would have never pegged like Abby as
she's totally into it. We've kind of kicked around the thought of going to
a gathering.
A gathering.
Dude,
I don't know if I can. I don't know. Honest, it's funny because like, it's. So I was at the show. I went to the show, and like ICP fans are some pretty interesting people.
Very interesting.
However, everybody was so fucking nice there.
Yeah.
You know, like, they look kind of crazy, but, like, everybody's totally cool.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, obviously, I was not a huge ICP fan. I was just kind of there hanging out.
Right.
You know? But
just taking it
like,
in.
Like, nobody was, like, an asshole to me, or nobody right. was, like, shitty or at any point, you know? So it's like, all right, I mean, the gathering, you're going to see some pretty fucked up stuff.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure.
But...
Well, I mean,
they seem like, hey, as long as you're cool and you want to hang out and not be an asshole, then come right. hang out, you know? So I don't know. We haven't made the commitment yet. But...
That's a commitment too, dude. Because it's usually like, come on down to the cornfields out in Kentucky.
Right.
Because that's the only place that will right. have
exactly.
us.
Exactly, yeah.
And then you're like, I am going to get murdered up in here.
And nobody will know.
No, yeah. never. They'll yeah. never find it's... my body. what was it, like 5-10 years ago, Tia Tequila, whatever her name was,
yeah,
she went to one of those things and they pelted her with feces. Human
right.
shit. They threw rocks and
did,
human
yeah.
shit at
it was,
her.
It was at the gathering, yeah.
I'm like,
yeah.
Who? What? Like, why? Whose shit? Are you, is it your own shit? Is it somebody else's shit? Why are you throwing human shit at somebody?
That's so funny. Oh. So, yeah. So, I'm a big Howard Stern fan, so I listen to him a lot on Sirius. And mm-hmm. he has Shaggy Two Dope and Violent J on probably about once a year. They come sure. on and they'll do a segment or a bit where they will send somebody to the gathering.
Really?
And just talk to people and interview them or whatever.
Sure.
So, yeah. So, it's funny to, like, to hear the shit that they uncover.
Right.
You know? But, yeah. So, it's...
Yeah. I know Dr. Drew has talked about wanting to go to the gathering.
Oh, my God.
I'm like, dude, Dr. Drew, they will eat
you
alive.
You have no business there. He has no business there.
None at all. Oh, man. Sure. Put a pin in this. So, yeah, that was pretty brave for you to go to a... ICP show with your wife.
It was actually I was surprised how much I enjoyed it.
Mm-hmm.
Not that I thought it was going to be like terrible,
right?
But yeah, it was more so just amazement.
Yeah, the people watching is fucking fantastic.
Yeah,
yeah.
She actually got on stage with them.
Did she really?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, there's always I feel like there's always a point in every show where like people get.
Pulled up or whatever.
Yeah. So, yeah, she got up and fucking shook up a bottle of Faygo and sprayed the crowd. And, yeah. So, I feel like for her, it was like a dream come true.
Oh, I'm sure. I'm sure. That's funny. Yeah, like, my wife is into, like, Train.
Nice.
And Gavin DeGraw.
Okay.
So, like, I'm like, all right, we'll go.
Yeah, that's yeah, fine. Yeah. I mean.
Yeah. Although, we did go to see Pink.
Okay.
We've seen Pink a couple times. Dude, Pink's fucking amazing live.
I bet. Yeah, I bet.
Like, she's fucking... I always liken her to the Pat Benatar of our generation.
Okay.
Because she's fucking rock and roll, man.
She is, yeah, yeah.
Despite the fact that she does a lot of pop music, she's fucking rock and roll, man. But, yeah.
That's good. And, you know, it's funny. Like, there's certain artists who... You hear them on the radio or, you know, on a CD or whatever... And you go to see them live, and it's just like listening to the CD.
Sure.
But there's other artists who you go see them live, and they put on a great show.
Sure.
You know?
Absolutely.
So,
yeah.
Again,
like,
you know, to my point, it's like, I don't follow Phish like I used to, you mm-hmm. know? But going to see them live is awesome.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? Like I said, like the sound quality is awesome. The energy is there, you know, and it's something.
Right.
Know?
The performance is there, like
exactly.
the technical
so
skill.
So that applies to a lot of artists. You know, there's some who you may not be a total fan of,
mm-hmm.
but when you see him live, you're like, wow, that was something.
Right.
You
absolutely.
Know? Cool.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely. And I'm still trying to find that perfect, like, artists that she and I can 100% agree on.
Yeah.
You know, just so we could be like, dude, they're coming to town.
Yeah.
We should go. Like, Pink is...
Something to get excited about.
Yeah, absolutely. And Pink is one of those artists, but, like, we saw her last summer, and it was, like, $25, $30 in the lawn down at Tinley Park. Worst venue ever.
Yeah. What's it called now?
The Fuck You Give Me Your Money Amphitheater, I think is what it's called. No, I think it's the Hollywood Casino Amphitheater.
I always think of it as the World.
Yeah, it's always the World Music Theater.
Yeah.
Just like Rosemont is always
the Rosemont.
Horizon.
Yeah, the Horizon, yeah. Not the Allstate Arena.
Mm-mm.
Yeah.
No. So, but yeah, she just played at the United Center, and the cheap seats were $80. Mm. I'm like, fuck
yeah,
that.
Yeah, I have a hard time with that.
Yeah.
I have a hard time with that.
Seriously. It's like, I have tickets to go see Foo Fighters.
Okay.
And Pearl Jam.
Nice.
Both at Wrigley.
Yeah. And same, like, show or
they're about a month apart.
Yeah, yeah.
But, like, you know, I've been following both of those bands since they
forever.
Started.
Yeah, forever. I remember back in the day, yeah.
Oh, totally.
Yeah.
And you know, I've missed Pearl Jam the last few times they've come through just because, like, the ticketing sucks.
Shame on you.
Nah, it's not my fault.
It's
dude.
Ticketing. It's hard ticketing. It's a hard ticket.
Well, because they go through Cubs ticketing.
Right.
Yep. And that's near impossible. Like, you would know, going through trying to get the dead tickets through there.
We got lucky, yeah.
Like, did you do through the fan club? Or mail order?
No, I didn't do mail order. It was through, like, we got a pre-sale code,
mm-hmm.
and we did it that way.
Nice. Yeah.
And so we actually scored tickets. And our tickets were, like, up, you know, up in the, you know, like, far away.
But even still, there.
Yeah,
it's,
you're there. Yeah, no.
You're in
so,
a ballpark. It ain't that far fucking away. And so, you're at Wrigley, for that matter.
Right. So we had some friends who went the night before and uncovered the system on how to get on the floor.
Oh, really?
And so we were able to get on the floor. And once you're on the floor, there's no seats. You're just there.
Yeah. You have to impart me on your ways for when I go to see the Foo Fighters.
Yeah, okay.
Because
yeah,
I'm in the... Eli and I went to go see the Foo Fighters 2 years ago when they played Wrigley.
Yeah.
And he knew somebody who was like a showrunner.
Yeah.
So, like, you know, they need beer. All right, go get beer.
Yeah.
Ended up getting on the floor with wristbands.
You just got to find a friend who has a floor ticket.
Yes. I don't know if I have anybody with a floor ticket
yet.
Just
find somebody in this world who has a floor ticket and try and get a photocopy of their ticket.
Really?
Yeah.
Right on. So, yeah, because I'm in the 500 level for Foo Fighters, which is ironic because I think I have the exact same seats that I had the last time I saw the Foo Fighters.
It's pretty up there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then for Pearl Jam, I'm on the floor.
Nice.
Yeah. I joined the fan club specifically because I was not going to miss seeing Pearl Jam there again. Like, the last few times that they've played there, I've had, like, an iPad, my phone, a computer.
Yeah.
I've had like 3 or 4 different devices going, plus like somebody else also trying to get tickets and just completely got shut out.
No, I know. No, I get it. I get it. Yeah. When we were, what show was it? There's a show we were trying to get tickets for, and it was myself. I had a desktop and a laptop, and Abby had, she was on a computer. Another friend of mine was on a computer, like on 2 computers. And so, like, I was like, I feel like I'm Emerson, Lake, and Palmer.
Yeah,
like,
right.
He runs all around you, you know, like, just fucking going at it. But sometimes that's what it takes, you know, and that's how we got tickets, so.
Yeah, actually, I knew some people that went to those Dead & Company shows.
Yeah.
And so that was a great time.
Yeah, it was good. It was pretty cool. I'm a Cubs fan. I'm not a hardcore baseball fan. I'm not a hardcore sports fan in general.
No, same.
But I like the Cubs.
Yeah.
But it was pretty cool being at a show on the floor. And, you know, and again, I'm not a fan of selfies either. But, like, I got a picture, like a selfie, like me and my group of friends, my wife and we were there.
Right.
Like, and like, we're on the ivy.
Yeah.
That was pretty cool.
Yeah.
You know, it's surreal being down there, like seeing Bob Weir and John Mayer and, you know, an old Shale Burbridge just fucking rocking it out. And, like, the ivy is, like, 2 feet from you.
Right.
You know? That's pretty cool.
Or even, like, just, like, you're looking at the stage, and then you turn around.
Yes.
And you're in the outfield, and you look up, and you see how massive that stadium is from the inside.
You see all the assholes who have the fucking shitty tickets.
Right? And you're like, ha, ha. You know? What are you doing? Laughing at jerks.
Nelson.
Right? But, like, it's surprising how big it is.
It is. Oh,
like,
yeah.
Because when you're in the stands, you're like, all right, there's the field.
Right.
But you turn around and you're like, what
you
the
never
fuck?
See it from that perspective.
Uh-uh.
You never do. And so.
And even if you're in the bleachers, you're like still high up.
Yeah,
but when
not,
you're on the floor,
you're
looking at holy shit.
Yeah, I agree.
Man.
I agree. Yeah. So it was pretty cool.
Yeah.
It was pretty cool.
Yeah. It's a crazy venue. Like, I'm surprised. Like, ever since the Rickenbackers or whatever, then the people who bought the Cubs.
Yes.
Ever since they took it over, they've like been like, all right, well, you know, the Cubs are off for about 3 days.
Yeah,
let's shoot a show in here.
Pumping money into the whole operation. Yeah. Good for them.
Dude, have you, well, like, I went there last summer to go see Green Day, and it had been like a year and a half since the last time I'd been there. Dude, the entire, like, neighborhood is completely different.
Yes.
Like, I'm like, what the fuck?
Yeah, like the Taco Bell, the McDonald's is gone. Yeah. Now. Like, yeah, they're going to.
Like, there's high-rise buildings there. I'm like, where's the metro? Like, you got to look around, like what the fuck is going on?
It's the Ricketts family.
The
right?
Ricketts. Yeah.
You know what? Good for that, man.
Right.
You know what?
It was just kind of a dumpy ass neighborhood up. Like once you got to Wrigley, once you got a little farther north than Wrigley, it was a dump. But you know that was the dump we spent our high schools at.
Right,
so.
Exactly. Yeah. No, so I'm glad they're making it nice.
Yeah, for sure. But yeah, like I saw the there's like a hotel and there's like this crazy high rise building. I'm like, what in the actual fuck is going on over here?
Yeah.
Because I don't get up there that often anymore. I don't get to the city. Yeah. Like
I don't either.
Like
I used to like when before kids and but even before I'm married when I was dating my wife, we would go to Chicago almost every weekend.
Really.
We just drive in and go see a show at a bar or something, or some band, whatever. And so, honestly, like 3 out of the 4 weekends a month, we'd go to Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I, you know,
like I work in the city sometimes, and it's like literally, like I go in and I fucking leave. I go in and I leave, and I'm like, I just don't like dealing with the traffic.
Just can't wait to get out of it.
Yeah,
I know.
It's too many people.
It is. I agree. Thank you.
Too many fucking people.
I agree.
You know, and I always tell the joke, too. It's like, you know, when you go out and you meet people, oh, where are you from? I'm from Chicago. And then you always have that one asshole that's with you like, you're not from Chicago. You're from the suburbs.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, I'm from Chicago until you see me put fucking ketchup on my hot dog. And then I'm fuck you.
Nice.
Yeah. I was thinking about that today because I was putting ketchup on my hot dog and I was like, man. I'm from the suburbs, bitch.
Yeah.
You know?
I don't care. The only time I tell people I'm from Chicago is when I'm, like, in Greece.
Or out of state.
Yeah. Like, in Greece. Because, like,
nobody knows
people
what
in
fuck
Greece
Aurora
don't know Aurora.
Are.
They don't know, like, you know, I'm like, yeah, I'm from Chicago. Oh, okay, great.
Right.
So, like, have you been shot at? Like, that's like, the next question,
you know? That's crazy. Like,
yeah.
Like, I haven't been out of the country in 2 years. So it's weird, like, especially ever since I got in office, like, it's interesting to, like, I'm itching to get out of the country again just to talk to people to see what the perception is outside
of
the country.
Yeah, you know, right. You know, last time I go to Greece every 2 to 3 years, you know, and so, like, we're due the summer, we're going, you know, and so it's funny. Last time I was in Greece. Obama was still in office. And I don't want to get into the whole political discussion, but talk about foreign perceptions.
Yeah.
Like, you know, in the village where we live, you know, it's a village.
Yeah.
It's not like a city. It's a small village on the side of a mountain. And like, you know, they're just, you know, they're, you know, the village mentality toward African Americans is like not a positive thing.
Right.
You know? So it's like, so they didn't take him seriously, you know? And so it's like, I'm actually,
well, what do they feel about Oompa Loompas?
I'm actually kind of used to like us. It's funny. Like us as Americans, like being like the joke, like over there, you know? Cause it's like, which is funny. Cause like Greece is like so tied up with political strife and,
right.
And economically it's
kind of fucked.
It's very fucked, you know? But like, it's funny that like, you know, like they still like, oh yeah, well you guys, you know?
Right. Like, we didn't file bankruptcy, motherfucker.
I know. It's hilarious.
Like
it's
your
funny.
Food is awesome, but
it's so funny. It's so funny. I love it.
Yeah.
It's great. Yeah. It's like, oh yeah. It's like they'll try and like make their own political commentary and like talk shit.
Mm-hmm.
But it's like, how about your 25% unemployment rate? What's
right.
Oh, well that's different.
Right. That's man. Why you got to bring up old shit? That's funny, man. Yeah. Like, I've been itching to get out of the country. Kirsten and I were talking about going to England in the fall, but I think we're going to have to push that off to next year just because money.
Yeah.
Stupid
sure,
money.
Man.
But yeah, because I'd been to El Salvador every year for 8 years.
Yeah.
Just hanging out with you know, orphans and shit. Like,
yeah,
this place that I was going to in El Salvador was great. But because I liked hanging out with the kids because the sure. kids were awesome.
Sure.
But then you see a bunch of bullshit going on behind the scenes. And now I'm like, I got kids, like, I can't leave.
Yeah.
You know, I can't leave my wife with two kids here at the house. It's insanity.
No.
Especially being that far away.
Yep.
So,
yeah.
But yeah, like, that's the thing that I think most Americans need is to get the fuck out of the country, at least go somewhere.
In general. No matter where you're from.
Just get out of the country for a minute.
No matter what country you're from.
Get out of the country.
Go see something else.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. Like,
because, right, I mean, the world is a crazy place.
Dude, and it's huge.
Right, and you should really take the time to experience something different.
Oh, absolutely.
And I don't care where you go.
Right.
You know, I'm not going to say you need to go here or here. Just go somewhere else that's different from where you're at today.
Dude, it's like my mother has barely left the state in the last 25 years.
I know a lot of people like that.
Like, why? Why? Yeah. There's so much to see.
There's people I work with that who have never gotten a passport. And I took my 7-year-old today to get a new one.
That's rad.
She's on her second passport already, you know? So it's like, all right, you know, like, let's fucking just go somewhere.
Right. Absolutely. Dude, go to Canada. Go to Mexico. Just
something.
Do something.
Yeah.
Get out.
Yeah. Eh?
You know? Yeah, right. Dude, I love Canada. Like, I worked in Canada for a month.
Yeah.
Back in 2007, I was up in Vancouver. And, dude, I loved it.
Yeah.
I absolutely loved it. And, like,
supposedly, the weed up there is awesome.
Dude, it was ridiculous. Yeah. Like, you just go up to the art museum, and, like, there's some hippie kids, like, out back, and you're just like, what you got?
What you want, eh?
Yeah, right? I did get taken by one hippie. Am I, did I get taken twice? I think I got taken twice.
So what do you mean by taken? Like,
you gave the dude some money, and then all of a sudden he disappeared?
Okay.
Yeah.
Not, like, sexually.
No, not sexually.
Okay, all right.
I have a specific set of skills. But no, and then I ran into the dude. I'm like, dude, what the hell? Yeah. You took my $20, you ran off, you never came back. I never got any weed.
He's like, you're still here?
He's like, oh, I'm sorry, eh? Yeah. I was hungry.
No, he didn't say sorry. I'm sorry.
Sorry.
I'm sorry.
Sorry. I'm like, dude, if you needed $20 for food, I'd have given you $20 for some food.
I would give you $20 in real money, not Canadian money.
Yeah, right?
Yeah.
Mine's got an eagle on it, motherfucker.
I have relatives in Canada, and it's growing up, like, we always made fun of Canadians.
Oh, yeah.
Like, for sure. Like, my cousin.
Yeah. You know?
And he was always a good sport about it, but it was...
Well, they have to be. They're Canadian. Like, yeah. I love Canada, man. I talk shit, but
you know,
dude, I love Canada.
A lot of awesome comedians came out of Canada.
Oh, dude, so, yeah.
I mean, like, Kids in the Hall?
Oh, all of them.
Fucking love it.
Yeah, dude. Yeah. Like, dude, a lot of our great actors are from there.
Yes.
Like,
yes.
Dude, Michael J. Fox.
Seth Rogen. Yeah.
Evan Goldberg.
Yeah.
Like, all those guys are all from Canada.
Jewish Canadians at that.
Yeah. Yeah. Speaking of Jews, how's Noah? Have you spoken with him lately?
I have not. The update is he's doing well. He is happily married in California, owns his own production company.
Really? Good for him.
And recently had a child. So,
right on. Yeah. Right on, yeah. Because I know Andrew, I think, is up in Milwaukee.
He's in the Milwaukee area.
But, yep. Yeah, he and his wife just had a kid.
They have a baby. Yeah. She's a couple years old now.
Yeah, she's cute. She's cute. I see adorable. Updates on Instagram or Facebook or one of them.
IG, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But Ziggler's still out there fighting the fight.
Yes.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah. I haven't talked to him in a while. I talked to him probably 3 or 4 months ago, but I haven't really had a chance to, like, talk to him because he's too busy
fighting the fight,
I guess.
Somebody's got to.
Yeah. Well, it's not going to be me. I got shit to take care of.
It's not going to be me either.
I don't like to get maced.
I'm just trying to figure out, like, what's my plan for tomorrow.
Yeah, seriously, dude. Yeah. Like, do we have food?
Yeah.
Is there food in the kitchen?
Shit, we're out of milk.
Right. God damn it. I'll stop at Woodman's on the way home.
Exactly. Which, by the way, I bought milk on the way up here.
Sitting in a car.
Because we ran out of milk today. Yeah, so.
That's hilarious.
That's top of mind for me.
Dude, it's amazing. Like,
I don't have time for social justice.
Seriously.
I really don't.
Well, because you got kids.
Yeah. Trying to take care of my own.
Right. For sure. Like, I'll make sure my kids don't grow up to be assholes. That's how I'm going to fix social justice. Yeah.
No, I want to be like a little bit assholes. Just like a little bit.
Well, yeah. Just, you know, you don't want them to have to eat a bunch of shit. But at the same time, you're like, you know, like, don't fuck with nobody like bad. Like
that bad. Exactly. Yeah.
Like,
exactly.
Dude, even Cooper just put out a book.
What?
Yes. Dan Cooper just wrote a book.
Oh, my God. That's funny.
Yeah. Like, I'm like, I didn't know Dan could read, much less write a fucking book, you know, but I'm happy for him. Like, something about like social injustice or something.
Good for him.
Yeah. Dan turned out to be way smarter than like I gave him credit for.
He's the first person who hooked me up with cassettes.
Really?
Of Grateful Dead and Fish on cassette.
Really?
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
It's funny how many people like in our group were into that. Like you, Dan, Dylan. And like I remember the first time I ever heard Fish, we were riding around in Helga.
Yeah, Helga.
And Helga was our buddy Marty's family's VW microbus.
Yeah.
And he put in Junta.
Nice.
And I think I told him, like, what the fuck is this bullshit? Take this out. Put something in that rocks.
Yeah.
I think was the gist of what I told Dylan. And like ironically, 4 years later, like I'm you know, dropping Molly at a show and enjoying the fuck out of myself. So
that's funny you say that because I've been to many shows over the years and I'm thinking like years back, but
sure.
People walk around and be like, Molly, 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 Molly.
Like, nah, dude, my name's Ruben.
And I'm like, but like at that point, like, I don't know what the fuck that was.
Right.
And like, and I remember being like really like intoxicated and somebody's like, Molly, and I'm like, I don't know what the fuck that is. I exploded. I'm like, what the fuck, man? Like, I don't even know what that is. Like, leave me alone, you know? Like, and then like a year after that, I like learned what it was. But
you're
I,
like, Molly, do you have any?
Yeah,
hello.
But I was like, so I was like, no, like, no, like, out of principle, I'm not doing that,
right?
Because for so many years, people would come up to me and I had no idea,
be annoying about it.
Yeah, and it was like very annoying. So,
yeah.
Yeah.
Dude, and I just miss, like, the thing that I miss so much about those shows were, like, the vending.
Yeah.
Like, dude, you could get some cool shit back then, man. Like, there was this burrito guy, or, like, not the burrito guy, but the fucking, there was this egg roll guy.
Yeah.
Who used to tour around with Fish. And he would make an egg roll the size of a Chipotle burrito.
Yeah.
Dude. Oh, God, I miss lot food, man. I miss lot food so bad.
We always had a joke, my brother and I, older brother and I, because when I was going to Fish shows in the late 90s, he would always, you know, it was him and I and our friends. But, like, it was like you see the guy selling
whatever,
grilled cheese, whatever, you know, and it was like, hey, grilled cheese, veggie burritos, whatever. But then, like, it was like inevitable, like, after the show, it was fatty grilled cheese, fatty veggie burritos.
Why
it's
is
like,
everything
oh,
fatty?
Like, what's so different about it? Like, what makes it fatty?
Fatty is it like I smoked like seven of them in the show, man.
Exactly.
I just need to like get some money to get to the next show.
Exactly.
Like I would totally like purchase a grilled cheese sandwich from somebody so they could get to the next show. The people that annoyed the fuck out of me were the ones who were like, dude, do you got a dollar? I'm trying to get to the next show.
Yeah,
fuck
no.
You. This guy's selling something.
Yeah,
at least like, he's being a productive member of society.
Service.
Yeah,
provide
right?
a service.
He's providing a service. He's being a productive member of society.
Yeah. At least he's selling fatty veggie burritos.
Right? Dude, you just have veggie burritos. These are fatty. Fuck you and your
fatty.
Regular ones.
Yeah, fuck you.
Oh, man.
It's such a capitalist market.
Dude, seriously.
Even amongst the hippies.
Seriously.
It's like, it really is.
Yeah, right.
That's
dude,
it's so funny. So it's like as much as they want to be like, oh, yeah, you know, like socialist ideologies or whatever.
You're
no,
still
man.
Trying to
you're,
get one up
still
on somebody.
Trying to fucking sell shit. And
right.
They have their own tactics to sell what they want to sell.
Right.
And it's, yeah. Oh. It's a capitalist market no matter where you're at.
Yeah. The thing that I miss the most, though, ganja goo balls. Dude, I've been sober, like, weed-wise for almost 10 years now, and,
yeah,
like, every now and again, god damn it, A goo ball would sound fantastic.
Yeah, well, you know.
Might chill me out with my children. Dude, I know you want it. I'm sorry, buddy. You don't have to cry. Oh, man.
You should look into that.
Yeah, my wife's not down with the fucking sickness, man. My wife's not down with it at all. So, yeah. Mostly because it's still illegal. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. That's when I found out that it was on the, should we put this on the up for a vote? I'm like, all right, I got to go vote now. Goddamn. So, I voted in the primary. I was like, bullshit one, bullshit two, bullshit three, bullshit three. Should we vote for weed? Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Stupid. Why is this even up for debate?
Yeah.
So, but yeah. Dude, lot food was so good, though. Like, I probably got the shits like five times, but it didn't matter because it was delicious in my mouth at that moment.
Yep.
So, all right, dude. Well, we are at like the 2-hour mark already. Okay. So, I will, let's just cut this loose. We more than welcome to come back anytime you want to come back, dude. It's been a lot of fun catching up for sure.
Thank you.
But you also have like about an hour drive back home, which is going to suck balls.
Fine.
No, it sucks. So, but yeah, dude, is there any way anybody listening can, find you out?
Yeah, no.
No. Don't look for Chris.
Yeah.
Don't look for him. Like,
it's not that interesting.
But if you're looking for shows, hit me up.
Yeah.
I can relay a message.
Yeah.
So, but for Pop Goulash this week, I'm Ruben.
And I'm Christos.
Be kind to one another.